taking up two items regarding residential parking permit, and as you may have noticed last night, four of us will not be participating in item 14 because we have some ethical reason why we cannot be participating in the decision, because we have some type of, like my husband has a lease downtown, or people live in the downtown area. So we will be taking up item 13, which is the framework of the residential parking permit program that will be going for the entire city of Palo Alto. So let me read just a little summary and introduce it for staff. In January, the council directed staff to develop a procedure for neighborhoods to request and implement residential parking permit programs, and do this while designing a program for the downtown neighborhoods due to their saturation by workers during workers parking all day long. The objective is to preserve neighborhood quality of life by ensuring adequate parking for residents. The residential parking permit program is one of a number of parking management strategies council is actively considering to reduce traffic and expand parking options. Staff is recommending that council adopt the framework ordinance, which is attachment C to chapter 1050 of the Palo Alto Municipal Code, which will establish the official policy for neighborhood-specific residential parking permit districts across Palo Alto. I will turn this over for staff for presentation. This is a public hearing. Then we will be opening the public hearing. And actually, if you couldn't help me, last night I did not declare the public hearing open when we did take public comment. So if you could maybe help me with how we can recover from that. It was a long night. So if you wouldn't mind helping me with that, Cara.
Sure. Cara Silver, Senior Assistant City Attorney. I would recommend that after the staff report that you do open the public hearing and allow anybody in the audience to speak. And you also can take into account the speakers that spoke last night, even though they weren't technically, the hearing hadn't technically been open.
Thank you very much. We can go ahead and do this just by the announcement that we will accept last night's public comment as part of the public hearing. Okay, great. In that case, I'm going to turn this over to staff for presentation, and then we will open the public hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Shepherd. Good evening, Mayor Shepherd and members of council. So tonight we are discussing two items, the first of which is the citywide ordinance for the designation of RPP districts. I have a short presentation for us to quickly kind of highlight some of the main points of the ordinance and the work that the downtown stakeholder group has done for the last 10 months to help develop this program for us. So very quickly, I'm going to just talk a little bit about the context of RPP as really part of our holistic parking strategy. I'll provide a quick overview of the proposed framework and how we think it should work, and then I'll kind of give a high-level overview of the ordinance, and then we will open it up for discussion. So you've probably seen many iterations of this diagram over the last few months, but I think it's really critical that as we talk about our parking strategies, we really do consider it as part of this, really part of a whole, our integrated parking strategy. And RPP is really a parking management strategy in that it helps to regulate who can park where, for how long, and at what cost. And I think as we've really evolved our thinking through a lot of these strategies in the past year and pushed a lot of our parking programs forward, it's become very evident to us that parking management strategies are critical to overall success of the programs. So the RPP strategy, the technology we're looking at implementing in the garages, our new garage branding and signage, all of these things are going to help us make best use of our existing parking assets. Then we have our transportation demand reduction strategies. So these are strategies we're looking at to help us reduce the number of cars that are driven in around the city. A lot of exciting programs happening there. And then, of course, parking supply. So implementing programs that help increase the amount of supply, even as we attempt to manage it more effectively. So I think the message here is really that we've made great strides this year in a lot of different parking sort of components of this program. And really RPP is a keystone program that helps us start to manage all of these things much more effectively. So with that said, the proposed framework that we're looking at is quite similar to what we discussed 11 months ago. The citywide ordinance is really meant to be a sort of umbrella document which outlines general criteria that a neighborhood needs to meet in order to become an RPP district. The ordinance also outlines the petition process that is required for a neighborhood to go through, but the ordinance is not specific about things like hours of enforcement or numbers of permits. All of those details would be completed in a neighborhood-specific resolution, which is the other item that we'll hear tonight. And so the neighborhood-specific resolutions will be developed as part of the process for a neighborhood that's interested in becoming an RPP district. And then the third component of the program would be the administrative regulations, which we have not developed yet, but that component is really, it's really administrative. It's things like, you know, what are the technical requirements for how we conduct occupancy studies to prove the parking saturation? And what are the eligibility requirements for people to purchase permits and how do they purchase them? The administrative regulations will be developed if we move forward with the program. And they will be developed in conjunction with vendors that we are in the process of bringing on board to help us move forward. So by way of a little bit of context, we have two existing parking permit programs that I just wanted to touch on quickly. The College Terrace RPP program is our only existing true RPP program in the city. And it was designed to help prioritize resident parking in the College Terrace neighborhood. That program was created by an ordinance, which is a very detailed and inclusive document, an ordinance that really outlines almost every last bit of how that program works. And then the Crescent Park No Overnight program, which really isn't an RPP program because while it does regulate parking in the neighborhoods, it regulates resident parking. So it's slightly different, and it's a no overnight parking program, and that was created not by ordinance, but by a resolution. The resolution is a pretty simple document, and so I just sort of want to bring these up because both of these programs, I think, should be considered predecessors to a more formalized approach of how we develop parking programs. And I think that one of the main points of the ordinance is to really try to standardize how we develop the programs moving forward. So I'm going to quickly give an overview of the ordinance. Obviously, it is provided in Attachment C. The first thing that we include in the ordinance is qualitative RPP designation criteria. And we talked a lot about qualitative criteria versus quantitative criteria. And we ended up with four things that are qualitative. And I will talk a little bit about the sort of issues with the quantitative stuff as well. But basically, and I'm just going to paraphrase these because the ordinance says it slightly differently. But the first criteria for any neighborhood to be designated an RPP district is that non-resident vehicles interfere with the use of parking by neighborhood residents. The second is that the interference happens frequently. The third is that this interference has some disruption to neighborhood quality of life, e.g. it makes it difficult to find a parking spot or creates other traffic hazards or other problems. And then the fourth is that other strategies are not feasible or practical. And the stakeholder group and I discussed at length the idea of including quantitative criteria in this piece as well, and we ultimately did not because we felt that different neighborhoods in the city really do have different characteristics. And while there might be a place for that type of criteria, we didn't want the sort of blanket ordinance to have a sort of quantitative number in it. But I will show some examples of what other cities have done just to sort of compare. So the second part of the ordinance is the idea that a neighborhood that wants to become an RPP district goes through this petition process. So the planning department would develop a sort of standard application that a neighborhood leader or group of leaders would fill out, complete a petition, And this application would include a recommendation for a district in its entirety. An alternative way would be that City Council could come forward and propose a district in its entirety for consideration as well. So the Planning Department and Director would review all of the applications by March 31st of the particular year, review them in the context of do they meet the criteria that we're looking for, and how, you know, how difficult really is the parking situation in that area, and then make a recommendation to the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission would review all the applications and ultimately respond and say, this is the neighborhood that you should move forward with. At this point, once the district has been decided, we would move forward with a community outreach phase. Essentially, this is the for the downtown district. That's what we've been doing for the last year or so. That outreach phase would include occupancy studies. And then ultimately, as part of that outreach process, we would develop a resolution which will be brought back to the Planning Commission by September, or no later than September of that year, and then be presented to Council. So the idea is that we want to involve both the Planning Commission and the Council, but we want to sort of minimize the amount of time as much as possible that we can take to do the work that needs to be done, get the community outreach done, and then get it back to Council, you know, basically within 7 or 8 months. Then the ordinance outlines that you know, this resolution should be adopted and can have a trial period of up to 2 years. It also allows for annexing and termination of districts. So annexing meaning that an area that's not part of a proposed district can essentially petition itself into the district or out by the petition process. And then the last thing that the ordinance does is it allows for contract parking enforcement, which is something that we don't have a municipal provision to do, but we wanted to introduce the idea that it might be a better way to enforce the district based on costs and sort of oversight and management of the program. And so I apologize if this slide's a little hard to read, but I wanted to throw in some of the quantitative criteria that other cities use when sort of looking at how they develop RPP districts. Pretty much every city that we've looked at does have a neighborhood petition process. That's fairly standard, although the number of signatures required and the sort of percentage of signatures is a little different depending on where you look. Some cities want 51% of the signatures on a block. Some want 2/3. San Mateo actually does not require a neighborhood petition to implement an RPP district. They're sort of leaving it up to the applicant to determine the best way to do it. And then as far as occupancy thresholds that are you know, that are looked for in neighborhoods, you can also see that some cities, San Mateo's as low as 60%. This would be the lowest parking occupancy that would be required to move forward an RPP district, and San Francisco's is 80. And then other cities don't identify an occupancy threshold at all. So I just wanted to sort of show that as context for how our ordinance falls. So with that, we recommend adoption of the citywide ordinance by Council. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, I'm going to open the public hearing and also include the comments from last night from agenda item 13 as part of tonight's public hearing. This is when those from the public can come up and speak on this agenda item. You will have 3 minutes, and our first speaker will be Tommy Derrick, to be followed by Frank Slattery.
Well, here we are. I don't know if when Larry made this motion way back, he thought it would take us this long to get here or we'd go through this process, but here we are, and that's the good part. So we're here tonight to support the adoption of this ordinance and the resolution that you're going to deal with afterwards. At the Planning Commission, we presented a request to include a specific item 10.050 or 0.50.040. We got a favorable response from the Planning Commission in general, and they referred it back to staff to ask them to review that proposal and consider including it in the ordinance. What the staff has included in 0.040, we think is a very good beginning We also think it's missing some essential items that were in what we proposed. We believe you, as the council, as elected leaders of this city, should also have the authority to designate an area, not just the petition process, but designate an area that you see as in need of a residential parking permit program, and the authority to direct the staff to produce a resolution for review of that district. It's abundantly clear that there are other parts of this city right now that are facing massive intrusion that is undoubtedly going to get worse rapidly. Anybody that's familiar with what's going on with the California Avenue development knows that's coming with the number of projects that are on the way. We do not want to use our limited tax dollars and limited staff resources to study what you can see and already know exists. And therefore, we want you to be able to designate a district. There are lots of different opinions about how this process has worked in the development of this resolution. But one thing is abundantly clear, and that is that we don't need to repeat it again and again and again. We are smarter now. We know how to do this simply and quickly. I suggest to you that we don't need to do the Palo Alto process just because we can. We can save the Palo Alto process for other issues. We ask you to take the leadership for which you were selected, give yourselves the authority to move swiftly, directively, and productively, and the establishment of RPPs where needed. The proposal we have put forth has an abundance of instances for public input and review, with council meetings, planning commission, public hearings, etc. What is not mandated is the process for the staff to study what is already known. We suggest that subparts D and E of 10050, etc., are not only not essential, they are harmful. We respectfully request that you replace the staff recommendation of 10050.040 with our proposal. A copy should be in front of each of you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Frank Slattery, to be followed by Norm Beamer. Okay, Frank must not be here tonight. This is Norm Beamer.
Good evening. I support the ordinance and the resolution. It's clear that an RPP program is needed for the areas that are being impacted by commercial non-resident parking. All anyone has to do is drive or walk around the affected areas near business districts to see that these programs are necessary. But I do have a comment on section 10.50.80 of the ordinance, which is entitled Annexation of New Areas to Existing Districts, which was mentioned in the presentation. This provision allows blocks that are adjacent to parking permit districts to opt into the permit program. The provision is necessary because once the requirement for parking permits goes into effect, there will be many non-resident commuters who will want to park just over the boundaries of the district for free. In other words, we shouldn't have a situation where we're spreading the commercial parking problem to neighborhoods adjacent to the parking permit districts. There's a fundamental unfairness in solving one neighborhood's problem by just transferring it to adjacent neighbors. However, even if adjacent blocks are annexed into the parking district, it would defeat the purpose of the non-resident parking permit program if non-resident permits were distributed for use in the annexed areas. An important goal of the RPP program is to force a significant number of non-residents who now use the residential streets as a free parking lot to adopt alternative ways to get to work. If we just allow non-resident permits to spread out into the annexed areas, that would undercut participation in transportation demand management solutions, purchasing permits in the garages, or using satellite parking facilities, for example. Instead, commuters will simply park in the annexed areas and walk or bike a little further to work. Therefore, a proper implementation of the annexation provision presumably by means of the administrative regulations that were referred to earlier, should not allow any non-resident commuter parking permits in the annex blocks. Only resident parking permits should be allowed in those adjacent blocks, notwithstanding that there may be non-resident parking allowed in the original district. There's no justification for extending commercial parking to areas that historically have never been parking choices for commercial use. It would be and would be unlikely to become such absent commuters being incentivized to do so by a poorly implemented RPP program. Thanks.
Thank you. The next speaker is Jeff Trom. He might not be here tonight. And Thomas Layton. Layton, thank you. Not here. And finally, Herb Borak.
Good evening. I support the comments by Tommy Derrick and Norm Beamer. In addition, on the annexation section, there needs to be some indication of the timing of that. If it's treated the same as the processing of the initial permit area, it'll take a very long time for an annexation to be processed. So you need to have some sort of direction as to how that would be processed. In regard to permits for low-wage workers, I don't believe that the other permit holders should be subsidizing them. It should be their employers who should be paying the full price of the permit. If the only way for those workers to be able to work for those businesses is to get a permit, it should be the employer who should pay for it if the employee cannot afford it. In regard to the process itself, on pages 3 and 4 of the draft ordinance, the first time that hours of enforcement are in the ordinance are when a draft resolution comes from the city attorney's office. So it's unclear at what point that kind of detail begins. Are you expecting the administrative regulations to say what should be in the application, including hours of enforcement, or is that kind of direction more appropriate in the ordinance? Similarly, in terms of what is required to qualify in terms of numbers or percentages, as was indicated by staff, other communities have a variety of percentages, and here is just delegating to staff to do it without a public process to determine what those are. In regard to disabled placards or license plates, the question is, why would that be needed if they're going to be visitors or guests of residents who are already having means to get those people legally parked? There's such a wide variety of reasons for disabilities, not just physical ones that would prevent people from using a disabled placard to park in a neighborhood and then commute downtown. And finally, in terms of school district exemption for school district events, does that mean that everybody would be exempt because who parks there? Because it doesn't show there's any indication of how to identify the particular vehicles that would be parked for a school event. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to now close the public hearing. Would staff want to make any comments to anything that's been said from the public?
Thank you, Mayor Shepherd. Hillary Gittleman, the planning director. I think we're prepared to answer council questions on any of the issues that have been raised. Obviously, we think the ordinance we presented is responsive to the stakeholders' input and to the Planning Commission's input that we received in their recommendation to the council.
All right, thank you very much. In that case, I'm open for colleagues. Questions? Councilmember Holman?
Okay, I'll jump into the fray here. And I'm going to focus really on the ordinance. And I have a few questions or comments. Under purpose, and a couple of things to begin with. I want to thank staff for getting this to this point in time. I know it's been a long, arduous process, and the stakeholders groups or members have been diligent and long patience also in doing this. And I told Jessica privately, but I will tell her publicly so you all can hear it, and especially her superiors, in quotes, that I have heard so many positive comments about your efforts, your work, and your diligence, and your commitment that we all should applaud you, and I do, and thank you very much. And I've embarrassed you, and I'm sorry. But the ordinance itself, I go to 2050-010, the purpose, and about midway down the line that starts institutions, parking programs that appropriately address each neighborhood's unique characteristics. And
yeah,
I'm sorry, I'm on the ordinance attachment C.
Right. Which number?
1050-010, purpose, about halfway down the line that starts institutions.
Got it.
So it says institutions, parking programs that appropriately address each neighborhood's unique characteristics. So in thinking about this and in reading this, I'm reminded of the comp plan language that talks about parking not, now I'm forgetting the language, not at the expense of, I think that's the language, not at the expense of the neighborhoods. And so when I read this language, it seems very vague. What does it mean, appropriately address? And so I came up with three alternatives. One is parking programs that appropriately address the preservation of each neighborhood's unique characteristics. And I'm going to leave it at that and see where any other colleagues have comments on that. I think that's more consistent with the intention of the comprehensive plan and provides.
Say the language just one more
time. Yes, that appropriately address the preservation of each neighborhood's unique characteristics. And again, I think that's more consistent with the comp plan intentions. A question on the next page, which would be 1050, well, under definitions, 1050-020, C. It's a clarifying question for me. Is employee permit, it shall mean a permit issued for an employee working at a business located within an RPP district. So can employees or an employer share a permit? We've had this conversation about parking garages. So it's a clarification about can these permits be shared among employees with the same employer? And how would that work or not?
Thank you, Councilmember Holman. So I think that's a question that we weren't really intending to address in the ordinance, but more in the resolution for the downtown areas. But our intent is that a permit that could be issued for an employee would be transferable within employees of the same business.
Okay, thank you for that. And initiation by City Council. The City Council may by motion or resolution. Why is it either or? Just explain that, what is meant by that, by motion or resolution. Because how would the council by resolution initiate consideration of an RPP?
Thank you, Councilmember.
It seems like a resolution is the outcome of.
Yeah, thank you, Councilmember Holman. I think that we just picked that up from the member of the public who suggested this language at the Planning Commission. I think you're right. It would, in all likelihood, just simply be a motion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we would, in that case, delete or resolution, again, because resolution is the outcome. On the next page, I have to remind myself of my comments here, I'm sorry. Okay, under 1C, prioritization of applications, on the third from the last line, or starts on the fourth from the last line, in making its recommendations, at the last meeting I had to apologize for my cold, so I'll do it once now and leave it at that. In making its recommendations, the commission shall consider the severity of non-residential parking impacts. So is there clarity somewhere here that I haven't recognized that talks about how that severity is determined? We've had neighbors who have been very involved in graphing what the impacts are. Is staff intending on doing that? Or so what is going to be the threshold here, the measuring stick, so to speak?
Thank you, Councilmember Holman. I think we envisioned at this point in the year, if multiple neighborhoods came forward and wanted consideration of a district, they would essentially be advocating for prioritization and would provide information about why they believe the situation in the neighborhood is intolerable and what circumstances exist. So they would be providing that information to assist the commission in advising us and determining how to prioritize. This whole idea of prioritizing, if you remember way back to our discussion early this year, was just in a recognition that we probably can't design and implement RPP districts in every neighborhood at once. So we're going to have to find a way to prioritize. And this was our suggestion.
So what you're saying is that basically the commission will weigh all evidence, basically.
That's correct.
Okay. Under 1D, same page, staff review of applications, community outreach. Once an application has been selected for council consideration, what happens to the ones that the director or then later the commission doesn't recommend for consideration? And the reason I bring that up is because sometimes there might be, you know, council might have also interest in something that hasn't been recommended. So are those provided as background, or will they also be provided as, you know, here are the also-rans, or what will happen to those?
Oh, well, thank you.
And is there an appeal process, I guess, also? Don't want to introduce something.
That's a good question. I think we can be comforted that none of this is going to happen in secret. Everyone will know which neighborhoods are advocating for a district and will be party to the discussions and the decision about prioritization if that's made at the Planning Commission. And with the addition of paragraph 040, initiation by City Council, effectively the City Council has the ability to jump ahead of the line or assert their preference for a district that hasn't been included, or add a district to the top of the pile. So I think there's a wide variety of ways that this can happen. We would just hope that whether it happens at the commission or the council, there's some acknowledgement of the limited number of resources and the inability to do everything at once.
Of course, and yes, I'm just looking for all of this. People are going to be very vocal about what they want or don't want. But I just want to see that even those who aren't being considered for prioritization, that information is going to be provided.
Yes.
So,
I think we'll all know about it and we'll have an opportunity to react.
Okay, very good. Then I've been interested in why resolutions versus ordinances. So that's kind of a broader question, I guess. Why resolutions versus ordinances? I don't know if one of the attorneys wants to respond to that, or Hillary.
Thank you, Councilmember Holman. So the resolution is something that we thought could be implemented more quickly, and there's not really a need for it to go through the elaborate process of a first reading, a second reading, and then 31 days, you know, thereafter, because the public process has already been present in the lead up to the adoption of the resolution. And so, you know, you certainly could change the resolution process to an ordinance process. It would just, you know, delay the implementation of each district.
Okay, and a resolution has the same force of law as an ordinance. And a resolution would also require a city council amendment to change.
Yes, correct. Okay. To both of those.
Okay, great. And then I think my next to last question is, I think there's a typo on, this is page 4, 1050060B1. I believe that's supposed to be 1050, not 1005030. So that's a typo that should be corrected. And then the suggested or recommended language by the speaker in their typewritten language should also be corrected to 1050040. Does staff want to comment on that provided suggested language to replace the staff language?
Yeah, thank you, Councilmember Holman, and thanks to the member of the public for providing this comparison. I think when we looked at the suggested language, we wanted to stick as closely to it as we could, but we wanted to acknowledge that in all likelihood, the process would benefit the outreach process and the Planning Commission review process that's called for in both versions of this would benefit from the data collection and analysis that is left out of the suggested language from the member of the public. So the language we've put in the ordinance as our recommendation calls for a data collection and analysis by staff, as well as public outreach and the Planning Commission recommendation. If I'm reading the suggested language from the member of the public, they acknowledge community outreach and Planning Commission review, but that data collection and analysis phase has been omitted.
So you believe all the concerns that are proposed here and highlighted here are already addressed in the staff recommended language?
I think we felt that the language as we've proposed it is more appropriate. It would provide for a more informed discussion when this when the council initiated RPP was being discussed in community outreach and at the Planning Commission.
And then Mr. Beamer's comments, I'm sympathetic to, and that's 1050080, annexation of new areas to existing districts. I think he makes a good point about not introducing commercial parking in those neighborhoods that haven't previously been impacted by commercial parking. So if we're trying to encourage people to find alternative means, so what is staff's response to that? You know, we've already gotten emails from several neighborhoods that, I shouldn't say several, some neighborhoods who say that people are already using their neighborhood as a satellite area and people carpool basically from another neighborhood in Palo Alto and go downtown or wherever. So does staff have a comment on Mr. Beamer's suggestion?
Thank you, Councilmember Holman. Maybe Jessica can amplify this, but I think we think of this as something that should probably be addressed in the resolution on a district-by-district basis. In the downtown area, for example, I think one of the precepts that the stakeholder group identified was that we should share the pain. You know, that in a district like downtown, you want, if there's going to be employee parking, you want it to be distributed evenly. That would probably be true in some other areas of the city as well, but in other areas, as Mr. Beamer points out, you might want to not let that occur. So we think of that issue as something that would be established, something that would be dealt with in the district-specific resolution to the extent that it needed to be.
Okay. And lastly, 1050-100. A, no person shall stop, stand, or park a vehicle adjacent to any curb. I don't know how a person stands a vehicle. So I think there's an extra word in there, as I read it anyway. Page 6, 1050-100A. I think the word stand should be deleted.
Yes, I think that's correct.
And those are my comments and questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Price?
Yes, thank you very much. Again, I can't say enough how impressed I am by the outcome here. I'm going to almost declare a preliminary victory before we even continue. I think that this effort in this environment with strongly held beliefs by many stakeholders, you've done a yo person's job here, and I want to commend you and the staff involved. I have a couple of clarification questions. One of them is under the issue of the time period, the initiation, let's see. Director reviews all applications by March 31st, and staff brings a resolution to the PTC by September, and I'm trying to find where that is in the ordinance here. My question is this. Why do you believe it will take 7 or 8 months? Realistic? Are you being cautious? Or why do you think it would take that long? Because some of these issues, you will be standardizing an approach, and there'll be, you know, some refinements.
Thank you, Councilmember Price. I think that's a good question. I think our intent here was really to sort of set a maximum. Our hope and our desire is that it would not take that long. But we do know that, I mean, for instance, in the downtown district, it has taken that long and longer. But yes, we hope to standardize the processes, and it may be that fewer community meetings and may be needed in different neighborhoods. So mm-hmm. I think we just wanted to sort of set a maximum time limit without sort of being too restrictive.
Okay. Because I do think once you get a cadence going here, recognizing their peculiarities and issues that will emerge, another question I have is the issue under penalties. Where was this? Violations and penalties. I appreciate what you have here, but I guess my concern, and maybe this is something that will be more in the administrative regs as well, I'm not sure, is if something like permit fraud emerges. Unless we have a system and we pick a vendor somehow who is able to make this pretty secure, I'm not sure that this is, I don't think the results are strict enough. I guess it's an open question in my mind, the possibility of considering a financial penalty in addition to the issue of misdemeanor and et cetera, et cetera. Do you have comments about that?
Councilmember Price, I'm afraid I don't. I think this was our suggestion. Not knowing what might occur, I would hesitate to recommend a change. We could certainly consult with the police department to see if they have any further input on this issue, but this was our first stab at it.
And obviously that as things move along, you can consider revising this. I mean, I know I sound like I'm sitting here with a hammer, and that's not my intention. It's just that I just have this feeling that this could happen. In lovely Palo Alto, this could happen.
I just want to add, I think we agree with you, and this clause is really just sort of meant to lay the umbrella for saying that, you know, permit fraud is not, it's not legal. But ultimately, as we onboard the online permit sales vendor and our enforcement folks, this is a major issue that we're going to be working with them to, you know, really get their input on, because depending on the types of permits you have and how they're transferable, those decisions make a big impact on how permits can be fraudulently produced or sold. So I think this was sort of just a way of saying that we recognize this is not okay, and then we're going to have to work through the specifics of how we handle it in the administrative regulations.
Okay, thank you very much. The other two more quick comments under 10.50.060 under permanent adoption. We provide later in this document ways to opt out, ways to amend, etc. So strictly speaking, it's not permanent adoption. Is there, unless you can really defend permanent adoption, because we're providing all sorts of reasons why this can be changed. If you please comment.
That's right. I think permanent here just simply means the end of the trial. But
right.
The council can always change
right.
The districts.
Right. Okay. And let's see. Okay, a couple of quick comments. I don't recall your response in full to Councilmember Holman's question regarding non-residents in the annexed area, parking in the annexed area. If you could just quickly repeat what you said to Councilmember Holman.
So I think this is in reference to Mr. Beamer's comment.
Yes.
Around the sort of, for annexed areas, not allowing non-employee parking. I think I understand and I'm sympathetic to the intent of that, but I think this quickly gets complicated. The ordinance doesn't specify the issuance or non-issuance of employee permits. That's something that comes up in the in a specific resolution, such as the downtown area. So I think Hillary's comment that we would work that out as part of the resolution is correct, but also just thinking about how a program is rolled out, if we do have a program which allows some number of employee permits and you are proposing a way of allocating them amongst a certain geographic area, to then annex an area into that which doesn't have the same essentially characteristics as the original area is what you're running into. So I think I'm trying not to be too specific here about any particular area, but I think there's just something that we need to consider that would need to be worked out as part of that individual program's design.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. Thank you. And then just my last comment. Ideally, I agree with Mr. Borak's comments that employers should be paying the full price for these permits, not only for their workers, but including the service workers and minimum wage workers. However, it is my belief that the reality is not all employees get parking, allocation monies, stipends, et cetera, for their use, and I am particularly concerned about the low-wage, minimum-wage worker in terms of, I really appreciate, it's come up several times, that we're making that distinction, and I think it's extremely important in order to provide opportunities for people to park who are minimum-wage workers or low-wage workers. And like I said, it's my belief that it often falls on the employee, not the employer. I'd like to see employers embrace those benefits, but we're not in a position to be working in that milieu, but it is a concern of mine. Thank you for your work.
Councilmember Klein.
Uh, Well, to echo what everybody else is saying, I'm very glad that we are where we are, and kudos to staff for bringing along a lot of people who maybe thought they never were going to be able to agree. I'm concerned about a few things. The first one is the price of permits. I know that's not in here, and that's going to be subject to the regulations, but this is a theme that you're going to hear from me, and I'm concerned about that in a variety of ways. And since we've promised the public we're going to be in effect by January 1, at least starting the process, I'm willing to live with the regulations accomplishing a lot of these things. But I do think we have to have some language in here somewhere that we're going to treat all districts the same. One criticism we hear from people who don't like the idea of residential parking permits, and even some who do, is I shouldn't have to pay for my permit. Well, we already have two districts where people do pay for their permits. Different situations and so on and so forth. But I think we have to make clear that we're not going to go through a negotiation with each district each time where somebody says, I shouldn't have to pay anything, and we're charging Crescent Park $100 and some other district 25 or 50. So I really want to have something in place here which indicates that we're going to charge all of our districts the same. Is that feasible, or tell me why we shouldn't have that? And I think it might ease the negotiations as we go along when we say, sorry, this is the council's policy, and if you really want a residential parking permit, and I'm not saying what I'm not objecting to the idea that we charge non-residents more or anything of that nature, but I think that we have to have a uniform policy.
Thank you, Councilmember Klein. I think we don't object to your idea. I think you're right. It would make implementation of districts easier from the city's perspective. I'd just point out that currently we have two parking programs, and we do not currently charge the same amount in each district.
No, I understand that.
I can't tell you exactly how they evolved to have different prices, but they do. I'd also tell you that when we did our survey in the downtown area, we had a lot of feedback from residents, mostly because of the design of the program with the trial period, an objection to paying during the trial period. And so I think putting the pricing question off to the resolution in each specific district does provide some flexibility. With that said, I think it would be easier if all districts were created equal. I'm not sure exactly how we would do that in the text of this ordinance, but
well, maybe we can give that assignment to the legal staff to come up with some language while we're talking about it, and see if the rest of the council agrees with me that we need something like that. And I don't have any, Hillary, I don't have any problem with a trial period being at zero cost, but I just think we have to have certainty and an understanding. I mean, if the city decides it wants to give everybody free permits, okay, then we ought to know what that's going to cost the city. And if people know that it's going to cost them X dollars on a permanent zone, then they ought to know that up front as well. Okay, that's my first thing. Uniformity. Second, I want to know what procedures we're going to follow in preparing these regulations. I want to be sure that there is adequate notice, participation, so on and so forth, all of the usual Brown Act type things, transparency, so that the public does know and can participate in the drafting of regulations, which I think are going to be important here.
We're happy to accept that type of public input, and we anticipate that the regulations at this point will come back to the council as a, you know, as a draft, and so the public will be able to weigh in both at the public meeting and also, I imagine, we'll have a community meeting as well.
Okay. So do you have some suggested language for that as well, or you will?
I'm happy to propose something.
Yes, I understand.
Okay.
I'm just one person here. On the language on 20, excuse me, on not 20, 10.50.040, the language proposed by Mr. Derrick and what we have from the council, I really think that they are very close, but I think he pointed out a problem that I want just reassurance from, because actually, as I recall things, it came up when we were considering the virtually dead on arrival program of residential parking permits in the Professorville neighborhood a couple of years back. And that is to not require citizens to go through the same process of getting petitions and so on and so forth if the council takes the initiative. So I just want to hear you say that by the language that's proposed by staff, when the council initiates consideration of an RPP district, that to undertake the analysis and outreach process, that the outreach does not go to the extent of requiring people to sign petitions and circulate them and so on and so forth, as they would have to do under, what is it, 50.050.
Thank you, Councilmember Klein. I believe what we've done in that section 040 is refer to the process outlined in subparagraph D and E in 050. And so the applicant, the neighborhood wouldn't have to do a petition, but there would be an analysis of parking occupancy by staff, and then there would be a resident survey undertaken by city staff prior to bringing the suggested district to the Planning Commission for review.
Okay, is this more or less than the survey that this would be the same survey that we would be doing in any event, is that correct?
That's right, this would be the same type of survey, but the neighborhood residents wouldn't have to do a petition as they would if they were petitioning for priority.
Okay, so the council action is a replacement of the petition.
That's correct. It's not.
Good. Thank you. Okay, I have some concern about some of the definitions and how they work. There seems to be an assumption in several places here that only employees are the outsiders impacting the neighborhood. And so I want to hear more about the other three possibilities we've been talking about, which are Pali High School students, Stanford students, and commuters from outside Palo Alto who want to get to Palo Alto so they can take the bullet train to San Francisco. So they, for example, may be living on the campus, they might be living in Menlo Park, whatever. So how are we treating them?
Thank you, Councilmember Klein. I think under the terms of this ordinance, those categories would not be eligible for permits, although that's really spelled out in the resolution, not so much in the ordinance. I don't know whether Cara or Jessica, you have anything to add to that.
Well, that's the way I read the ordinance as well. I also read the ordinance as if there's an employee who doesn't work in the RPP area, that person also would not be eligible for a non-resident permit, correct?
I think that was our intention, yes. Okay. Although I could imagine a situation where the council could adopt a resolution in a specific district that had a somewhat different approach to this issue, if that was warranted. I don't think that would be precluded by the definitions here.
Yeah, let me just add to that. I think our intent here was not to list every type of permit that could potentially be you know, issued in a particular neighborhood. I do think we want to include that in the neighborhood-specific resolution, but I do understand your point that we've listed employee permit here. There might be another sort of permit that we could list, but I think our intent was not to include an exhaustive list in the ordinance.
I'm not necessarily objecting, but I just want to make sure that what we're doing is favoring one non-resident group over other non-resident groups.
Yes, we are favoring the employees who work within that district, not employees who work elsewhere or Stanford, you know, people who are commuting to other institutions or neighborhoods.
Okay, I'm willing to go along with it because I think this is really a trial, and we are going to find out a lot about it, but I don't think right now we have any data for example, on the three groups that I've just mentioned. I want to focus just a little bit on the exemption for school. I think I can't remember who brought that up. Focusing on D7 on page 5, talking about the school events. Have we checked that out with the school district? Whether that, I think, for example, if we had an RPP in the neighborhoods adjacent to the high schools, particularly Palo, whether that would really, 5 is really sufficient when you talk about the various activities that go on there. So I'm just looking for whether we've really coordinated that with the school district.
No, we haven't.
Okay, I would urge you to check that and see whether that's really going to work. That one raised the question to me of city events. And being very personal on this, I happen to live in the neighborhood that gets overflow parking from events at Rinconada Park. For example, the Clay Festival and some other ones where there's a few times a year lots of non-residents parking on my street in front of my house. How are we handling that? Should we have a section on that for the city? And more in particular, more to get it away from the personal, the Middlefield Road, it's close to being in a potential RPP, has lots of cars parked along it for the community theater events that take place at Lucy Stern.
Thank you, Councilmember Klein. Just going back to the purpose of the ordinance, I think all along we were trying to design an ordinance and enable neighborhood-specific programs to address the impacts of parking associated with nearby businesses, although the purpose says with nearby businesses and institutional uses. So there's some flexibility there. I think if the council wished to use this ordinance as a framework to adopt a resolution that specifically addressed some of those other intrusions.
I think you're going to have to. I'm interested in moving along, but I think by covering schools, you've opened the question about city events as well.
Understood.
And I think you're going to need something to cover city events as well. That's all. And that's all my questions.
Councilmember Schmidt.
Yeah, thanks for all the work you've done on this, and hopefully we can move ahead promptly and forthrightly on this. Just a couple of follow-up questions to issues that have been brought up. The definition set under 1050.02, number C is employee permits, means a permit issued for an employee working within an RPP district. Now that makes sense for downtown, but suppose the next district that comes up is Evergreen Park or Ventura, and they get a RPP in there, and lo and behold, they find that There's no employees who work in that district because it's a residential district. The downtown district is different because it started by looking at this large area. But what happens when other areas come in piecemeal? Are they excluding employees from California Avenue?
Thank you, Councilmember Schmidt. I don't think we're trying to exclude or really make an inclusive list of all the types of situations that we're going to run into. So I think you're absolutely right. We might need to make another definition, but I think the place to identify that is probably the resolution for that area.
Okay, it would be good though in the ordinance to say nearby business districts or something. Number two, the annexation issue is an interesting one, but if you do approve that there should be no employee permits entered there, that would induce every neighborhood on the fringe of a potential district to stay out for now and become an annexation. So careful of gaming the system here. Mr. Derrick's point on the amendment having a different statement for the city council, I did note in the PTC hearings that four of the six residential stakeholders came and stated very explicitly they wanted a larger role for the city council to have an open, transparent discussions of things that was able to bypass the year-long process described in D&E. Now, that was a pretty powerful statement when the majority of the residential stakeholders came and said, let's have a role where the council can short circuit in a way this, what has been, at least for the downtown, a year-long process. So it makes sense, I think, as we move away from the downtown toward other areas, that maybe the learnings from the downtown are more obvious. The problems might come from smaller developments approved by the city council. And so the ability to move quickly on that has a lot of merit. What do you think about that?
Well, thank you, Councilmember Schmidt. I think we agree, which is why we included at the Planning Commission's recommendation that Section 040, initiation by City Council. So this would allow the City Council basically to, and a neighborhood to bypass that prioritization, you know, the petition collection and advocacy and prioritization part of the process.
Yeah, but as Mr. Derrick pointed out, the key issue really is the subsections D and E.
Yes. Yes, we did thank, as I explained to earlier when Councilmember Holman raised this question, we did thank, this being Palo Alto, that the public outreach and council and Planning Commission deliberations would benefit from the data and analysis that's referred to in subsection D.
Yeah, I did note also in the discussion on packet page 903 that the D and E very explicitly were identified as areas that would leave priority setting in the hands of the PTC. Now that's...
Thank you, Councilmember Schmidt. I think there was a discussion of prioritization by the PTC when we got to the question of permit sales, but so I'd have to go back and read that section of the minutes.
It was a discussion that took place after the four resident commissioner stakeholders had each gotten up and said the city council should have some priority. So I think we should be very careful with that particular statement and clarify it in, you know, I think Mr. Derrick has given us some language that we could work with.
I'm sorry, I didn't quite hear what you said. You're suggesting a modification to 040 or?
Yes, I think that is a way of dealing with the council ability to identify an issue that has arisen in the community and deal with it in a prompt way with all the learnings we have gotten from downtown and other areas.
Just so I understand, so you're recommending the citizens, the comment language that would bypass the data collection and analysis phase prior to bringing it to the Planning Commission? Because it really, as far as I can tell, what they've suggested just cuts out that data collection and analysis in subparagraph D.
It doesn't necessarily cut it out, but it does prioritize clearly what, you know, along a timeline determined by the council.
Just to clarify, Councilmember Schmidt, the ordinance that the Planning Commission was reviewing didn't contain the City Council bypass language. That's been added subsequently in response to the community's comments and the PTC's direction.
I think if you look at packet page 902-903, it has the discussion of the council initiated, but the priority setting remains in the hands of the PTC. That's what the language was on those pages. So maybe you could take a look at that. And
you can make a motion.
I guess on 1050.06, establishment of the districts, it gives the City Council is the body that establishes the parking district, and you define there in section B all the things that need to be done. Now, one of the things that's missing in there are any mention of fees. As a matter of fact, I don't think there's any mention of fees except in the heading of 1050.07, but it never says anything about setting of fees. Where shouldn't that be in the resolution?
Yes, I think we're envisioning that the fees would be set in the resolution and not in the ordinance.
Yeah, there is an item 6 that says such other matters as the council may deem necessary. So I assume that deals with fees, maybe transferability, maybe order of priorities. I mean, there's a lot of issues that aren't mentioned in here. Maybe being explicit about giving some examples of these other issues, which tend to get a lot of time in the debate, of being specific of where.
You're right, Councilmember Schmidt. We could specifically mention those things there if we wanted to elaborate on other matters as deemed necessary and desirable.
Yeah. I just mentioned them because if you read through the minutes of the PTC, for example, those are the issues that come up again and again. So to be clear where the responsibility for them is would be helpful. Good, thank you very much.
Okay, Councilmember Berman.
So let me start off by, as all of my other colleagues have done, thanking staff for all the work that you guys have done. The resident group the resident and business rep group and all the work that they did. I know it's, I've had lots of conversations with folks throughout the year, and there have been times where, you know, folks thought that the whole process was falling apart, and I kind of held my breath and crossed my fingers and toes and hoped that that wasn't the case, because I think the end resolution is a good one and a really necessary step in setting up so many of the other, you know, transportation management issues and programs that we're going to be implementing this upcoming year. As I was thinking back on all this stuff, you know, 2014, was really the year of planning, and 2015 is going to be the initial year of execution. And there's going to be, I think, Councilmember Klein, you know, mentioned trial and error, and there's going to be plenty of that. And I hope that folks on the dais, on staff, and in the community understand that this isn't going to roll out perfectly in round one, but we've got to roll it out, and we've got to, you know, improve the process as we go, or else we're never, you know, the perfect can easily become the enemy of the good, and I hate it when that happens, and it happens a lot. I had a and I really enjoyed, and it's unfortunate that we heard a lot of public comment last night, and then we had a break, which had to happen, or else we would have gone till 4 a.m. And now we're talking now. But I think Elaine Wong from the public kind of really summarized it well, which is if we don't have an RP, I mean, the RPP is the backbone for so many of these other efforts, including TDM and others. And so I think, you know, this is a really, really, really important night for starting to address the concerns that residents have been expressing to the council for years about the decrease in quality of life in their neighborhoods. I had a nice conversation with Mr. Derrick a couple of days ago, or last week or Monday, I don't remember anymore. And I think it was just Monday, I think it was just yesterday, and it feels like it was a week and a half ago. And I appreciate him sending the section, I appreciate the you know, desire behind the changes. When I take a look at the proposed changes, and I take a look at what staff currently has, and this has already been talked about in different pieces tonight, but the two big things that I see not in the, that aren't included in the proposed language are the there doesn't have to be a parking occupancy study, and there doesn't have to be a resident petition. Those seem to be the two things missing. And I personally, I think those are two important steps because we're told time and time again here sitting on the dais, data. You've got to have data. You can't make decisions without data. And, you know, as much as I'd love to just be able to eyeball things and say, hey, there's a problem here, there's a problem there, if we don't have data, it's always open to disagreement and counterarguments from folks about what we're seeing. And so I think having those studies provides that data that we need to be able to be confident that we're making the right decisions. And I think the petition is incredibly important. We saw in the chart of different municipalities that have these types of programs that one didn't mandate a petition, and I think there was optional. But if we hadn't had a petition this time, we wouldn't have found out that there's a whole part of what was the original plan that clearly doesn't, you know, at this point, want to be a part of a downtown district that I shouldn't talk about because I'm going to be conflicted out of it. So I won't get into specifics, but I think a petition is incredibly important, not only to get feedback from residents, but also to educate residents. It's something that I've talked with Mr. Buchanan a lot about, is how do we educate residents about what's going to happen? How do we get them to pay attention and maybe even engage? And you know, the petition did that because people received something in the mail and saw something's happening, something's going to happen in my neighborhood. And I better learn more about it if I'm interested. So I do think those two elements are important to the process, and I support the ordinance as drafted and presented to us. So those are all the comments that I've got.
Councilmember Scharf.
Thank you. A couple things. So a lot of people have gone over a lot of the same issues that I had. So I guess on the exemptions. Someone mentioned the school issue. So I actually had some concerns too. that it wasn't broad enough, frankly, that there's a lot of events, you know, Lucy Stern has them. There's a garden tour that occurs in my neighborhood, and, you know, people park in front of my house when that occurs. You know, and I mean, so there's a lot of things that I think the American History Museum or American Heritage has events, and then people park all over that. I've been there. So I think we have to have some way, if there's an historical events going on in town, that those aren't impacted by this. I also think when you said schools, were you considering private schools as well? They're in the Palo Alto Unified School District. They're just not Palo Alto Unified businesses. They also have events. And, you know, they historically should also be able to have their events that they normally have. So there's probably weddings that are in a bunch of different places. I know Lucy Stern has weddings. Gamble Garden, yeah, Gamble Garden's in my neighborhood. They're always parking near my house when they have big events at Gamble Garden. I guess so. I'm just thinking about there's a lot of issues here that I think we haven't dealt with in terms of it being broad enough there. And then I actually was really also concerned about the violations and penalties. I really dislike when we overcharge for stuff. And by overcharge, I mean we create a misdemeanor by something that really should simply be a fine. And I'm completely with Gail that if people are, you know, illegally manufacturing permits and are setting up something like that, but I'm assuming that that's a felony under some other statute. I might be wrong, but I assume that it is. So there's that. But what I'm thinking is this. I'm thinking that, you know, you own an apartment here. You have a permit or a house. Someone comes and house sits for you. You know, you go away for 3 weeks or whatever. You give them your permit. That strikes me as a misdemeanor under here. And that just seems like overcharging. I mean, there could be lots of circumstances where someone gives the permit. I don't mind if they're fined for doing it. That's one thing. You know, it's another thing to have a misdemeanor. I doubt there's anyone in this room that has a misdemeanor on their record. And if there is, you know, it's a big issue. You know, people, it's you know, you can go to jail for, 6 months to a year? So I'm concerned about having misdemeanors in there. The other thing that I guess wasn't mentioned that I had some concerns about. So I was concerned the way the whole violation of penalties was written. I was concerned the way B was, and then I was concerned with C, in that C is a catch-all phrase, which says, no person shall buy or otherwise acquire for value or use any RPP district parking permit, guest permit, except as provided for in this chapter, which means if you're using it not as allowed in this chapter, it is therefore a misdemeanor. And so it's a broad cat dragnet clause, the way I read it, that brings in a misdemeanor. That would be C under 10.5100 under violations and penalties. So I actually do have real concerns with the way the violations and penalties are written. So I also, on the violations and penalties, it says, no person shall stop, stand, or park a vehicle adjacent to any curb in a residential preferential parking zone in violation of any posted or notice prohibition or restriction unless that person has a valid and current residential parking permit. So I understand that we're going to have, isn't it going to be in every place you can park for 2 hours or something like that? Are we really going to say, you know, you cannot park there at all under any circumstances for any time if you have, I mean, are we actually thinking that that's the kind of district that may be created? So if I drive up, park my car, and look at a map, I'm in violation of this. I mean, we're not going to have districts like that. I don't see it. I mean, are we planning districts like that? Right. Serious. I mean, it seems like I can't bring my car to a curb in some district and park it for
thank
5
you,
minutes.
Councilmember Sharper. I think what this is intending to say is that you can't violate the posted restrictions, and so it would depend on what the posted restrictions in that district are.
Okay, so let's say the posted restriction says I can't park and a fire hydrant. It's red. So does that mean that if I have a parking permit, I can now go park next to a fire hydrant because it says unless I have a parking permit? So what does it mean in terms of why does it need to say stop, stand, or park a vehicle? I mean, it could say park a vehicle in violation. but stop or stand? I mean, I don't get it.
Well, Councilmember Scharf, maybe you can suggest a clarification here. We're trying to say that people have to abide by the posted regulations in the RPP districts. And maybe we should have just said it that way.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's sort of what I think you should say. I mean, or you could just say, no person shall park a vehicle adjacent to any curb in a residential in violation of any posted or noticed prohibition or restriction. You could say it that way. So anyway, I thought that was just weird the way that's written. So what else do I have here? I did agree with Councilmember Berman on that, on his points about data collection. I think that's really important about getting, and I was unclear when you were, when he was talking about needing to get a petition. Did he mean a survey or a petition? I assume he meant a survey.
That's correct.
You kept saying petition, but I wanted to make sure you meant survey because I completely agree with you.
Yeah.
And are we saying that, I thought that was in the ordinance that you always needed to get the survey, or is it not in the ordinance?
That's right. The way it's currently written, even if the council were to initiate rather than a neighborhood initiate, the staff would have to conduct a survey.
Right. And I also was very sympathetic to Larry's points that he was asking staff to do that. Maybe I missed it, but I actually thought it would be easier if we did this, if we made a motion and kicked this off, and then people could go ahead and say, so I'd like to move the staff recommendation, and then we can add things or not everything, but I think we should have the basic thing. So I will move the staff ordinance.
Second.
It's moved by Councilmember Scharf that we accept the staff recommendation on attachment C for the ordinance, and seconded by the Vice Mayor Nez.
Okay. So I will just briefly speak to the motion.
Can I just ask a couple questions? I know Councilmember Holman did make some suggested changes with wording. Are you accepting those suggested changes in your motion?
So some of them I may and some of them I may not. I mean, I wrote down some of them. I didn't necessarily get them all. I actually thought it might make sense for each council member not to.
Let me ask a question
forever,
of staff then so that we can see how quickly we can get through this, because we do have people waiting for item 14. Do we have a second hearing on this, right? Okay, so tonight we have to accept it, or we can ask you to come back with some new wording. How granular, we have to get granular then on the actual ordinance in order to accept the ordinance. So if we want to make changes tonight, tonight's the night we do that. So.
Thank you, Mayor Shepherd. You can make some changes tonight. We can reflect those in the second reading and still have the ordinance be adopted. If they're very significant or the council wishes to make further refinements, then there can be, you know, yet another opportunity. You know, we can schedule a third hearing so that we get it right.
Can we then ask you to generally get it to be a little more different in some of the ordinance language here, as opposed to going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth tonight? Do you think you can manage that, Councilmember?
So how was
well, she, Molly, our city attorney, believes that she can take the interest to do some of the word changing and have that prepared for the second hearing. And then if we don't, then if the changes still are problematic in the second hearing, we can take it up again. Is that correct?
In general, it works better for council members to describe conceptually in some detail, and we'll ask you to clarify if we need that, what it is you'd like us to do rather than attempt to draft it as a group here tonight. So if you can describe the change that you'd like to see, then we can work with the language and come back.
Come back for another public hearing or for just in the second reading?
So it probably works as a second reading. If there are very substantial changes that affect third party rights this evening, then we will schedule that for another first reading.
Okay, good.
So the second reading would not be on consent then. We'd basically schedule it with a revised ordinance based on comments that one council member has made. And some of the council member comments seem to be in conflict.
No, I think that as people make their comments, you would either accept them as part of the amendment things change. So right now, you do yours, and then I will finish the round after the Vice Mayor speaks. We have Councilmember Burton, then myself, and then we can go with lights again to see if anybody has any changes that they want to ask the city attorney and the planning director to address.
Okay. So is it all right if I address some of the comments that other people have made then? Or should I just wait?
I think that that's fine. I think that you have to in order to get your portion of the motion out, but just if they can be general and not prescriptive right now.
All right, well, some of them are somewhat prescriptive because Karen made hers prescriptive. I would agree with Karen's take out the word resolution, frankly. I thought that was on, that's at 1050.040. I did write that down. Is that accepted by the seconder? So if you look at page 2.
1050, we're just dropping
Karen
the.
Karen said at 1050.040 that the city council made by motion, and you take out the words or resolution. And I would agree with that.
Yes. Crossed out right now.
All right. On number C, someone made the point about the employee permit shall mean a permit issued for someone working in the district, and that we may have districts like the Evergreen District, frankly, where people are not in the district. I thought the definition should change and say, an employee permit shall mean a permit issued for an employee working in Palo Alto, and then when you actually do the district, you can determine who gets to stay and what the parameters are of that.
Ooh.
Well, okay, but I mean, so I don't understand how the program works because it says, so mean an employee working in a business located within an RPP district. So if you do the California Avenue area and you don't include, say, California Avenue itself, you do the Evergreen District, then you don't have those businesses in that, and they may not. So it all depends on how you draw those boundaries. You may very well have people working on El Camino who park there. You know, it's different than the downtown areas. I could see lots of areas. And you may decide when you do that district that you don't want any employee parking permits. But here you limit that. Or are we saying that when we do these individual ones, we can override what's in here? That's really the question. Or if what's in here, you can no longer override it.
Councilmember Scharf, would it make sense to say employee permit shall mean a permit issued for an employee working at a business located within an RPP district or as defined within the district-specific resolution?
That would be fine.
Okay.
Good. Is that acceptable?
Yes. Okay. And it's clearer.
I wanted to add in Larry's language if you had it. I don't know if you had it at the time.
Can you remind us which portion?
Yeah, where is it?
What Larry
So language? Larry's point was about you should have a uniform price for this. Oh. But I understood it to be just the residents, not. But do the residents and businesses would pay the same amount, or you could?
Kara has the language. If you want to hear it.
Yeah. On. Page 4 of the of the ordinance, section 10.50.060B, we would suggest inserting a number 6, which says the permit rates, which by city council policy shall be set at uniform rates among all districts. And then number 6 would become number 7.
So I would suggest language that actually says uniform rates for all residents. It does not say uniform rates for businesses, because you may actually want to charge different rates in different areas. We charge different amounts for permits in Cal Avenue, frankly, than we do in downtown. We may want downtown permits to be very expensive. We may have much cheaper permits in other places. So I would suggest that. Is that accepted?
Yes.
I didn't get that. I'm sorry.
So it's Larry's language, but it limits it to residents. So all residents would pay the same amount. But businesses could be charged different amounts depending on.
I think that's a good change.
And then, so on number 7.
Greg, if you're incorporating my changes, there were 2, and Kara has the other one as well.
What was the other one?
We will be going around for another round.
I'm not interested in another round. I'm just.
On page 6 of the ordinance, section 10.50.070EA, add a sentence that says, prior to adoption, the director shall conduct a public noticed meeting soliciting input on such guidelines.
That's fine. Is that acceptable to you?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Yeah, so if you move to number 7 under the exemptions, that would be on page 5, where we have the exemptions, which is D, and then number 7. I would like to see some language taking into consideration my comments that there are a lot of community events and how we handle that, and what you would suggest and how you would write that, frankly. I mean, I think that's too broad. Too vague.
So we did discuss that at a policy level. Most of the other types of events seem to occur in the evenings and on weekends when most of the regulations likely would not be in effect. So if there are particular daytime events at, you know, private schools or city organizations that you want us to address, we're happy to do that.
That's what I would like. I would like any private organization to be able to go ahead and say we're having an event and do that. Is that acceptable?
Mm-hmm.
May I ask a question or should I wait?
You know, I'm ready to as well, because this is particularly for the work week and not irregular events. And so this is the purpose of
well,
this.
And I think so, I was going to let Councilmember Burt make that comment, because he made that comment to me. Which was, most of these are Monday to Friday, but we don't say anywhere in here that we're only limited to this Monday through Friday, do we? I mean, we could have an RPP that's on the weekend, so unless we're going to say only Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, I think we have, this is the broad ordinance that is the framework.
That has enforcement implications.
Right, and...
And then, in terms of the violations and penalties, I don't think this... We talked about the language on the no stop or stand or park. You came up with some language. I'd like to include that. You did. Which was basically stand goes away. Stop or stand. Or stop or, yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm still back on the prior comment about the events. Would you be satisfied if we just struck the reference to the school district and a school? So it would just be a vehicle purpose of attending or participating in an event?
Yes, I would be fine with that.
And then they have to go through that process,
yes.
14 days in advance, et cetera.
I would be fine with that.
Okay, thank you.
I did think that the notion of checking with the school district or something was actually a good one, because I don't know if 5's the right number. I mean, but, and then in terms of 10.5, 100 violations and penalties, I thought we could, you know, get rid of the words stop or stand, right? I think that's what made sense. Is that all right, Councilmember Nitz?
Mm-hmm.
And then on the rest of the penalties, I am concerned about it being a misdemeanor. And I don't want to sit here and tell, but I would like staff, and maybe it's too vague, but I would like staff to come back and see if we could be clear if we need a misdemeanor and where that should be.
So you want an infraction?
I want it to be an infraction. I don't want it to be a misdemeanor.
And define penalties.
And define penalties.
Yeah. The city attorney always has discretion to charge as an infraction. So we can either leave it as is with that discretion, or we can change it to an infraction. It's
I would
a policy
prefer it
call.
Be changed to an infraction. Is that all right, Councilmember Nitz? I'm fine with the fine penalty.
You know, then we've got it listed here, and as it comes up, we can ask. I'm also, once Greg is.
So, all right, so that's what I have in there. Other things people said I agree with, but I'll let them.
Before I allow the vice mayor to speak to her second, we are 10 minutes after 10, and I really hadn't expected this to go on this long, because we still have people waiting for the next agenda item. So I'm hoping that we can get through this to the 10:30. And are we here? Is everybody ready to stay for the night and do item number 14 after this? I know
We've
I don't.
We've only got 5 of us.
Five of you.
At some point, we're going to evaporate.
Right, and it's been a long night for Finance Committee members.
It really has. Yeah.
So
comments substitute gratuitous.
Right. Okay. In that case, Vice Mayor Nitz, will you please speak to your second?
Well, I will speak to it, but I need to know, are we going to continue
to go up and down and change the wording on this yet again, because it's going to be difficult on staff, and it's difficult on all of us, especially those of us who are going to stay for the next item.
You mean that?
So are we getting close to something we can vote on? How many people need to make changes? More changes? Lots of
one,
Greg
two,
does.
Three. Yeah, he's going to unchange one.
It'll be quick.
Okay, because I feel bad for all of you who have been already here since 8 and 8:30 tonight. And I'm going to just say some general things. I think, if anything, what we ought to do at this point is just give this RPP a chance. Let it work. Let it. There will be problems with it. We're not going to make it absolutely perfect tonight. And I think this is one of those nights when we really are letting the perfect get in the way of the good. We are not the first city that has done an RPP. They exist all over the country. We may not get it exactly right tonight. Let's just get it and get it on, because we have beaten this. So remember that one of our goals in this was to look at everyday parking issues. I'm looking at Nielsen out there. That was one of the goals we had, and Richard, is try to find out who is parking downtown. Can we ferret this out in such a way that we can find out who is there and who belongs there? And I think that the planning director dealt with that very, very well tonight, to say, in this case, all groups are not created equal. You will have to prove that you can either live there or that you work in the area. And let me say it right out loud. If you happen to be working at Stanford and taking the Marguerite, if you're taking the train, whatever that may be, you will not be getting a permit. And I think it's important for us to say that tonight. As I said, I just don't think we're breaking new ground on this. I think staff has done a phenomenal job of taking all the input from all those groups, the shareholder group, other groups who have commented on this. This has been, as Gail said, I think it was yeoman's work. This really has. And it's taken lots of late nights and lots of commitment. I've seen Jessica out and about talking about what's going to happen. So I am simply going to second it at this point. Hope we move on. And please remember, as we go forth with this, we will not get it perfect tonight. We will eventually get it so that it really works and really makes a difference in our community. But I don't think we may get to dot every I across every T tonight.
Councilmember Burt.
Okay, first a question on the issue of transferring permits. Is that intended to be fully addressed in the resolutions?
Yes.
Okay. So I appreciate we don't want to be specific. I'm trying to think of whether we need any guidelines, but I'll defer that for now. Councilmember Holman had brought up in 010 under purpose alternative language, and I was thinking about alternatives, and I would like to propose where in that sixth line down it says parking programs that appropriately protect each neighborhood's unique characteristics.
That's fine with me.
Okay. All right. And then I want to turn to the events section 070D7. And I appreciate
077. What'd you say?
070D7, exemptions.
What page? Exemptions.
Yeah, page 5, the bottom, where Hillary had spoken about just exempting the reference to PAUSD, but the whole paragraph has interspersed references to school things. And it also gets very specific about the number of days, the 2-block radius. These are things that I would expect to be in the resolution level. And so what I would propose, and allowing the city attorney to come back with specific language, is that a broad description of the that events, the type of events and the frequency and those matters would be determined in the resolution.
I think that's better.
Okay. All right. And I wanted to go to this issue that's been brought up about within 040 and the alternative language and the trade-offs that I see that if there was a situation that was pretty bad suddenly, the language that's at our places would enable an even more expedited process. But I can see within the staff proposed language, I was going back and forth on this, and within the staff proposed language, the council could do in a way what I think Council Member Schmidt was talking about, which is express an urgency. And so we might have routine ways that we go about this, but the council in this staff proposed language could say, we want this done really quickly. And the second, if we went with the substitute language, I would think that most neighborhoods that were petitioning to get in would say, I want to bypass the regular system. And we'd every time go through trying to justify whether we have that bypass. So I think in the net, I can live with the staff proposed language on that section. In 080, I'm sorry, I'm just going to look through real quick here. And the issue of whether there should annexed areas, whether we should be allowed to sell worker permits in annexed areas. I think that there are some complexities to that. I think we in the points made by Mr. Beamer are good. I think what we really want to do within the ordinance is make clear that we're not indicating that worker permits are necessarily allowed in those annexed areas. And so we don't get into an assumption that any area that's annexed will necessarily have those. And so this goes back to, if we look at 060, B6, we were talking about adding other matters. And so I would suggest, and I didn't capture all of them, but it says such other matters as the council may deem necessary and desirable, including fees, comma, whether non-residential permits are allowed to be sold. And there was one other that somebody will probably remember. Is that acceptable?
Yes.
Pardon me? And transferability. Okay. I think that covers all my stuff. Oh, I want to say something else. I know this has already been stated by others, but I do want to commend staff for having really listened to the community and done a great job of absorbing a lot of different perspectives. And then second, I want to just say the presentation tonight was exceptionally clear and forthright, and it's really nice. Thanks.
Well, thank you, and thank you also for the outreach to the community. I think you have done a spectacular job, Jessica. I know I get feedback that people really have found you to be a great asset, and that is something that makes the city look really good. So thank you for the work that you've done and the composure and the practicality that you're bringing to a very tough issue. Most of my issues have been addressed. Councilmember Price has talked about the fact that once we get rolling on this, hopefully it will not take as long and we have a routine to it if we have to do that many neighborhoods, of course. And I am interested in making sure that neighborhoods next to neighborhoods that are applying and actually have been accepted for the process are notified to that. I found it interesting looking at the College Terrace material from 2009 that you did a environmental checklist and discussion of impacts, and I thought that that was very instructional, just going through that to see what the impacts would be. And yet I do know that I hear Evergreen Park got some of the parkers after that residential parking permit went into effect. And so, but I don't think they were at the table, and I know that you just can't do it all. I know that this is going to be one of the unintended consequences, that there will be this type of shift, and it's one of the reasons why this council, before Councilmember Berman and Vice Mayor Nis were on it, you know, decided not to go with the little three-block radius of a parking permit pilot in Professorville, because we knew it would just roll everything forward. So I am interested in making sure that it's well notified, and I know that's hard to do. I supported also the comment that Norman Beamer made regarding the concepts of allowing workers that weren't parking before, and I think that that does get to why we didn't do that pilot, that we just didn't want people rolling into another part of the community or the neighborhood that was not being parked yet by workers. And I noticed in the staff report that the College Terrace residential parking permit program would need to then conform to this at some point in time, and that would be addressed and shifted into it. And the way I understand it is they don't take alien parkers. Did I get that wrong? Because theirs is a traditional residential parking permit program where they are not allowing others to park in the neighborhood. And is that considered in this framework for neighborhoods?
I'm sorry, Mayor Shepherd, are you talking about Crescent Park or College Terrace?
College Terrace.
College Terrace is considered an RPP district, although it has its own governing.
You don't have worker parking permits.
Right, we wouldn't, if the College Terrace program was rolled under this ordinance, that would not mean necessarily, I mean, the ordinance is designed to accommodate different types of programs.
Well, theirs was, the way I read it here was Marguerite. I know that it really intensified with Facebook. And so Facebook was asked to do a TDM program, so there was an effort. I remember all the black shuttles that were going around town at that time.
Of course, now Facebook's gone.
Facebook is gone, but still, it was the Marguerite, the Stanford people parking there, and there was no accommodation to let some of them park there.
Right.
It's just traditional residential parking permit, and yet this framework, that's not part of the criteria.
Well, the framework doesn't specify whether there's non-residential parking allowed or not. It allows for different, it would allow College Terrace to continue the way it has been designed.
But what about a new neighborhood that wants to do what College Terrace did? Would they be allowed to get in the queue because they are having this type of impact, the same type of impact College Terrace has? And I quite frankly, I'll put it out right now. You know, I know that my neighborhood is getting the unintended consequences of the fact that Pally does a very strange way of issuing permits to the students to park on campus. And so they leave a lot of parking stalls open, and they are all in the neighborhood. And it's a real concern. And so I don't think that that's covered here at all.
Thank you, Mayor Shepherd. The concept of this framework is that each neighborhood would be subject to its own data collection and community outreach process and adoption of a resolution with provisions that would be specific to that neighborhood.
Okay.
So if another neighborhood like College Terrace walked in the door, they could design and we could adopt a program like that program. But another neighborhood might have a totally different set of circumstances that would be addressed in that resolution.
Okay, because I guess that gets to the point where this is worker-focused and dominant. But it still would apply for those neighborhoods that are being impacted by satellite parking or something like that. And I'm making it up right now, but where you are around, as Councilmember Klein described, you know, around Palo Alto High School, around, I'm not sure if Gunn is having this problem. I do hear some parts of Barron Park is having issues with parking, with kids parking and then walking in the back way. But those are the kinds of things that I want to make sure that those neighborhoods can apply. And actually, I know that Jaime has been illustrating that to my neighborhood because they say, well, you know, this is something you should get on the list to get on residential, you know, to get on the list to get a residential parking permit. And so I just want to be clear, because what I've heard tonight, it is more worker related and it is more dominant with being next to a district that has workers.
I think we're agreeing with you that this ordinance tonight provides the flexibility to do what is needed in individual neighborhoods.
Okay, great. Thank you. In that case, I would like to mention that I think that this is going to take some time for the neighbors to organize and to make the applications. And although that's been illustrated to my neighborhood, that this is something that's coming and that we should get in the line for it, our neighborhood might not get selected right away. And I think that that's also something that needs to be explained, you know, as people, you know, make the application. Opportunities to find ways to be accommodating, making the types of accommodations that some neighborhoods can make without actually going straight to a residential parking permit program. But I know that I've already had that feedback, and then my feedback to that feedback is, you're right, but there's probably other areas and neighborhoods that might be ahead of our neighborhood on the particular saturation point of worker parking. So with that, those were my comments on this, and just to be practical when we're talking and reaching out to make sure that people are aware of the fact that this is there are limits as to how quickly this can go into the new neighborhoods and the parameters around how the priorities will work. With that, I think we have three colleagues that look like they want to do some wording changes before we vote. So I was going to go out to Councilmember Klein.
Very short and direct. I move that we amend the ordinance to restore the word misdemeanor at the end of section 10.50.100.
I don't hear a second for this, so. Ben. Fails for a lack of a second. Is that?
I'm gonna second it.
All right. Would you like to speak to your reasoning on this?
I want to hear his rationale.
Very briefly, this is common in our various ordinances. We hardly ever use it because, as the assistant city attorney has pointed out, it's within the discretion of the city attorney to charge lower, and she usually does. But what's being described there is really not just an infraction, or if it's really carried out badly, it's really sort of a fraud on the whole system. And I think that we should at least leave the discretion in the hands of the city attorney so that she's not handcuffed in really going after a serious violator.
Councilmember Price, would you like to speak to this?
Yes, I concur with those comments. I do have a question. My earlier comment was related to a fee structure or a penalty, and we might have the opportunity in the future if we wanted to do that. Is that correct? But not at this moment. We do not have a stated penalty, a financial penalty. So it's a question if in the future, if we wanted to do that, we have the flexibility to do that.
Yes, once a year the council updates its penalty resolution, and I think the council just passed its last resolution. But you could certainly do that the next time around.
Okay, thank you.
All right, I see no lights on this, so let's go ahead and vote. The motion to amend, remove the language for misdemeanor. And that motion fails with Councilmember Price and Councilmember Klein voting yes. I'm sorry. All right, Councilmember Holman.
Thank you. Just a couple of small things. That was the correction to 1050-060 B1. That correction should be to 1050 instead of 05030. And then the other thing, did the clerk capture that?
It's the transposition.
It's a transposition. It's a typo that just, you know, staff needs to capture. And the other thing is on the motion, the very last 1050060, right above the amendment, it says 1050060B6, and it needs to be clarified that that's actually the new B7. That's not a tack on to B6. It's the new B7. It note down just above amendment, the first amendment, the 1050060B6, down, that. It needs to be referenced that that is the new B7 when you're adding that language. And then I think it's a little bit clearer to, this says, with Councilmember Burt's permission, permits are allowed to be issued and transferred, if that's okay with Councilmember Burt.
Again, I think the city attorney is going to be going over this language more specifically, and so we can see it in the second reading.
Yeah, that's all I have.
That's it? Okay, and then I think I have one more, Councilmember Schmidt.
Staff inserted the B6 and made this B6.
Yeah, I think most of my items have been accepted as amendments in here, with the understanding that staff agreed on the 10.0504. That they would accept a council motion with urgency. Is that right?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
10.5, 50.04.
With urgency.
I'm afraid I still don't follow. So the 040, initiation by city council, you want to insert
Councilmember Burt said that this does not stop council from making a motion and putting the words with urgency in it, and that staff would accept that.
Of course.
Yeah, okay.
Are we putting the words with urgency in there, or just implying it? Thank you.
You want us to say that, yes, the council.
All right, I think we are ready to vote with the word changes and then look for the second reading. And we have passed an RPP framework unanimously. And thank you very much, those that have come out from the public, for holding in there with us. We're going to do conflicts, but I'm also going to ask colleagues if you could hold on to your council member questions, comments, and announcements for next Monday night, for those of us that are not going to be returning tonight for the adjournment of the meeting. And I'm going to be turning the meeting over to the vice mayor because my husband has a lease in the downtown district, and I will be unable to participate in this residential parking permit ordinance. Councilmember Berman.
So I'm also going to recuse myself from participating in this item. I own and reside in a condo on the 600 block of Forest Avenue downtown that could have a material gain or loss based on the outcome of this item.
Councilmember Scharf.
I'm also going to recuse myself. I have a commercial interest downtown that may or may not cause a conflict. Interest currently, I believe it does not, but haven't been able to make the determination fully yet. Okay. So, in an abundance of caution, I'm going to recuse myself.
Councilmember Holman.
Yes, while I live on the other side of Middlefield Road, it's very possible that the effects of implementation of residential permit parking districts may have an impact on my personal property.
And Madam Mayor, I need to recuse myself as city manager. My house is on Webster Street within the downtown district. And since I won't be here at the end of the evening, though, I would like to acknowledge the city manager's spectacular staff work by Jessica and Hillary, another piece of the puzzle in response to the parking and traffic challenges facing our cities. Very, very good.
Okay, everyone, our goal is going to be to move this along as briskly as we can. And this is introducing item number 14, and this is the resolution that establishes the residential parking program in the downtown neighborhoods. And this is kind of where it all started. So unless you have a preamble on this, I'm just going to, do you have a presentation?
We do. We will make it as brief as we can.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm going to see if I can do this presentation as quickly as I can. So tonight I'm going to present to you the work of about almost 11 months by myself and the stakeholder group that you'll hear a little bit about. I'm going to quickly go through some of the data we've collected on parking in the downtown as we've kind of designed this program. I'll outline the stakeholder process and recommendations for the downtown district, and we'll explain our recommendations for the resolution, and then we'll discuss. So again, we really see the RPP program, especially in downtown, as being crucial to kind of getting a handle on our parking and traffic concerns in the downtown area, along with all these other great programs we're working on, Zipcar, satellite parking, et cetera. So just a quick slide on some data we've been collecting for the past year at council's direction for looking really closely at garage occupancies. The dotted red line shows the sort of commercial parking standard, the industry parking standard for commercial parking lots at 85% full. And if you look at the different colored lines, these are the occupancies of our garages, which we measured monthly. Beginning at the beginning of this year up through October, kind of looking at where our occupancies are at the noon hour, you can see that Lot R is doing exceptionally well, often exceeding 100% occupancy due to our valet program there. And we still have some work to do at the other garages, particularly Civic Center has not been as full this year as we've seen it in recent years, and Cowper Webster as well. But overall, we aren't too far off the full mark during the noon hour in many cases. And despite the fact we continually have increased the number of permits sold at downtown garages, we don't really see a corresponding uptick in the occupancy of the garages, which really shows us that the issue that people are finding other places to park, i.e. in the neighborhoods. So looking at the parking in the neighborhoods, this is the most recent occupancy study we've conducted on street. You can look at the left-hand side, and that's the midnight count. Green basically means that the street blocks are 50% or less occupied. So you can see the baseline condition for most of the downtown area is green, with a few streets being yellow and even red in the middle of the night. And then we look at the noon hour and we see a very different picture. The red streets are showing the parking occupancy that's exceeding 85% during the noon hour. So taking a look at what that really means for us as far as commuters and or people coming into town for lunch, somewhere between 1,600 and 1,900 vehicles are coming into this area and parking. And that's really the challenge that we're trying to address with the downtown program. So As many of you know, the stakeholders that were selected by staff to participate in the development of this program design included 6 residents and 5 business leaders. And I do want to say that you will hear, I suspect, some very many differing viewpoints on, you know, some details of this program. But I just want to take a minute to stress that the group really did find consensus on many topics. I think even initially, nobody wanted to be in the same room as anyone else, but there really was a lot of consensus on many components of this program. And so I just want to applaud the stakeholders for that. The group agreed that we do need to sell permits to employees working downtown. They're too important to the livelihood of downtown to not be considered in this program. The proposed boundaries of the district, we'll talk a little bit about that in a minute, but overall the group more or less agreed on where the boundaries of the proposed district should be. The group also agreed, for the most part, that a phased approach to implementing RPP would be beneficial. Firstly, because it would help kind of eliminate this problem we have of the Caltrain or the Stanford Parker in the neighborhood. Everybody wanted the permits to be sold online, so there was agreement there. There was also universal agreement that supporting and prioritizing low-wage and hourly workers should be part of the program. And then more or less everyone agreed that the hours of enforcement of the program should be 8 to 5 Monday through Friday, although there were some areas where people felt potentially longer hours might be appropriate. So I'm going to summarize the program that's been designed by the stakeholder group and we'll be presenting tonight. And I'll kind of just add some color, I think, where it might be relevant. As I mentioned, the program we're proposing is a phased permit parking program. Phase one is proposed as being 6 months long. We will not issue permits to people who don't live or work downtown within the district as part of this phase. In fact, we won't issue permits ever to those folks. During this phase, we would give residents free permits. Employees could purchase permits, and the fees for the employee permits would be essentially the same as the downtown garages for standard employee permit, and then $50 for 6 months for a low-wage employee permit. We would define low-wage employees as making below a certainly hourly rate or annual income. During this phase, the city would collect data on the number of employees purchasing permits and look at the corresponding occupancies in the neighborhoods. All of the permits during this phase would be valid anywhere within the district. This was sort of the way of phasing the program. We felt that if we allowed employees with permits to park anywhere, we would get a better sense of really what the impact was before we started to regulate the location of the employee parking. During this phase, the city would send a follow-up survey to residents living in the district to confirm sort of qualitatively how the program's going and whether we should continue on into phase two. We would allow parking for 2 hours throughout the district with no permit. During phase two, which is basically immediately following the first phase, we would start to regulate the number of commuter/employee permit sales. During phase one, we would not limit the number of employee permits that we would sell, but during phase two, we would limit it based on data that we've gathered during phase one. And the idea here is that during phase one, we would eliminate the Caltrain and Stanford Parkers to determine, really maybe we don't need to limit to regulate employee permit sales. Maybe they're, the impact of subtracting the Caltrain Parkers is enough, which would be our hope. But ultimately, we may need to start to limit the employee permit sales as well. We would also start selling resident permits. The first permit would be offered for free, and then subsequent permits, $50 each. During this phase, we also want to emphasize the idea that, and actually during phase one as well, we do want to sell permits to not just employees, but to employers. Since we can't currently do that with the parking assessment district rules for our garages, but we do want to prioritize a way to do that for RPP permits in the new district. And then I think the main difference between phase two from the employee permit sales perspective is that we would start to regulate where the employees parked. meaning that employees would be assigned to a specific block or a specific number of blocks within the downtown district. This would eliminate the issue that we have identified of people trying to park closest to downtown along sort of Lytton and Bryant and areas where everybody's clustering. We would also allow that blocks that are adjacent to the immediate vicinity of the proposed area would be able to annex themselves in, as we discussed in the last item, via a petition process that's outlined in the ordinance. The hours of enforcement are 8 to 5, Monday through Friday, and two-hour parking in any one spot is valid without a permit. The non-permit holder can move their car within the district after 2 hours. So showing the boundaries and also giving some highlights of the survey that we conducted in August. So you can see on the left, the diagram shows the originally proposed boundaries, Palo Alto Avenue, Alma to the west, Embarcadero, and then Guinda to the east. We surveyed this entire area and basically asked everybody three questions. The first question was, are you for or against RPP based on, you know, some characteristics of a program where the permits would cost $50 and you'd be able to park for 2 hours and so forth. The second question was, how would you favor allocating employee spots or employees within the district with the understanding that at least initially we do need to sell permits to employees in downtown? And the third question was about the hours of enforcement. So the survey, I think it was a tough thing to do because we recognized we were trying to solicit input as well as sort of getting gauging feedback on something. But the survey was incredibly valuable in that it gave us a lot of good information. A huge number of people wrote back and said that they didn't feel like they should have to pay for permits. And we've discussed this a little bit already. But out of the 700 some odd people who voted no on this program, about 150 to 180 of them said something like the reason they were voting no is because the permits cost money. The results did not support the idea of marking employee spots on the street, which came up very early on in the stakeholder discussions as a way of sort of spreading out employee parking within the neighborhood. The residents were concerned about that idea. And generally, most of the people who responded supported the idea of having hours of enforcement being 8 to 5. So the other thing that I'll highlight coming back to the survey results is that it really was very close as far as the yes and no vote from very early on. A lot of people felt that the program was very important, and a lot of people felt that permits were too much of a hassle, et cetera, et cetera. But what we did notice in the geographic distribution of votes, because we did actually geocode every single vote we received block by block. And we noticed there was a very clear pattern where if you look south of Lincoln Street and east of Bryant, almost twice as many people were voting no as were voting yes. And those results were very consistent throughout the survey tallying process. So what we did with the survey results is we essentially changed the district boundary to not include that area. For Lincoln Street, we are recommending including the 300 and 400 block, but not the blocks to the east. And that was really based on the feedback we got from the survey. So the proposal is that for phase one, we would include only the area you see in green, just to sort of understand what the potential impact would be and then make a determination of whether the little triangle area should be included moving forward. Program implementation, as we have promised council, our goal is to begin implementation of the program in January. And understandably, there's a lot of services that we need to bring on board to make that happen. One of the things that we're doing is bringing on permit sales online. And so we're interviewing vendors this week to basically host and build us a website who would also be in charge of permit sales and fulfillment to people buying permits. Contract enforcement is another thing that would need to be brought on. We've looked at costs for enforcing the district, and I'll just go over those in a minute, but contract enforcement we want to make sure would be brought on board in time to provide appropriate training to get the program up and running. Then we would also need to install signs in the potential district. So if we can move the contracts forward, the vendors will be brought on in January, and we expect it would be at least a 60 to 90 day ramp up to get signs installed, to get the website online, and to get the contractors trained. So program costs, and this is also in the staff report. I won't really go through this line by line. I think it's not necessary, but as you can see, there are significant costs involved in looking at what the program will be. And actually, I apologize, there's a typo in the top row. That should say $250,000 for installation of signage, not $25,000. But so we have costs estimated here for all of those contracts I mentioned. We've also got staff costs estimated. And as you can see, there's one-time costs to sort of get programs up and running, and then there are ongoing costs that are estimated based on potential annual fees from vendors. Program revenues are again estimated, and I can't emphasize enough that the revenues, of course, depend on how many permits we sell and how much the permits cost. So if we look at the program as proposed, assuming that during phase two of the program we sold, if every resident household in the district purchased two permits, one of them was free, one of them was $50, that would be a certain amount of revenue, and so on and so forth. Sorry, Councilmember Burt, was that ongoing?
Yeah, the revenue.
Oh, sorry, that's annual revenue. Yes, good point. We expect that the initial, the phase one revenues would be less just because we're proposing giving resident permits for free. Wow, and that's my last slide. So our recommendation is that council adopt the resolution. Thank you.
Thanks, Jessica, very much. And if you're all comfortable with that, I'm going to take these cards. We've got eight people who want to speak to us who are in the audience. If you come down and get closer, we can move along a little bit more briskly. I'll greet everyone who wants to speak. Simon, is it Chins or Sins?
Yes.
Sins. And I have down that you also want to speak at the same time as your brother speaks?
Yeah.
Okay. Hang on just a sec. I'm going to read everyone. Maria Kwok, Michael Hodes, Richard Brand, Norman Beeman, and Herb Borak, and Frank Slattery. And, oh, good, Nielsen. Good. Okay. As I said, you don't have to take your whole 3 minutes, but you're welcome to.
I assume we have more than three because there's two of us. Is that correct?
Did you eat? Yes, if you both signed up, go
yes.
ahead.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Go ahead.
Okay. My name is Simon Sins. Ben, my brother, and I own two small commercial properties in the SOFA area. Ben is a Palo Alto resident. I am a member of the downtown stakeholder group. I also want to echo what other people said about the hard work that staff did. I think it was a major accomplishment. I also want to compliment my fellow stakeholders who all worked in good faith and all worked very hard. And I think we've gotten a major accomplishment here. So, and I'm supportive of that, or we and both Ben and I are supportive of that. Our family has owned these two properties for in the SOFA area for 60 years, and we hope to have them for many more years for our children and grandchildren. We're here tonight because we are concerned about the long-term well-being of the downtown business community. Our properties have served our family well, but they have also served Palo Alto well. At 1027 Alma, we have a home interior decorating company that has been with us for 15 years. 50% of the clients are Palo Alto residents. At 882 Emerson, we have a pediatric dentist who has been with us for 10 years. 60% of his patients are Palo Alto residents. Downtown businesses serve all of Palo Alto, not just the residents who live in the adjoining neighborhoods. We support the RPP ordinance and resolution, but some important changes are necessary, and I would be remiss if I did not bring these to your attention, okay? The most dangerous last-minute addition to the resolution that's in front of you is the employee permit transferability. On October 12th, the PTC added this provision without raising any concerns in the discussion. Now, transferability has come up before. There's different types of transferability. The first person in the morning shift uses the same person, the person in the afternoon shift. That's great. No problem with that. Good idea. But there's another type of transferability, which was specifically referred to in the staff presentation at the PDC, which says permits are transferable if employee leaves. And in the current language that is in front of you, that condition is not excluded, it is included, okay? So that's the type of transferability I'm concerned about, one that just permit continues and continues and continues, okay? Employee permit transferability will effectively privatize large portions of residential neighborhoods for the permanent and exclusive use of individual businesses. You have to put all the pieces together to see the real danger. Piece number one.
So that's the end of your time, or you can... Yes, right. So you get 3 minutes more, and you can both take it,
I'm going to continue talking.
Yeah,
okay.
Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Okay, piece number one. Employee permits will be issued by block. Only those employees who hold a permit for the 900 block of Ramona can park on that block. Number two, employee permits will be severely limited, with only 2 to 4 spaces available per block face. Number three, businesses will purchase permits that are closest to their place of business. Permits nearer the downtown will sell out quickly. Permits will be sold online. How fast can you say nanosecond? Number four, when Company A purchases 30 transferable permits for its employees, they will have privatized about 10 block faces for the permanent and exclusive use of only their own employees. Company B will do the same, and so on. Many downtown companies each employ dozens of workers. Some employ hundreds of workers. These companies will literally buy up the close-in parking. New businesses will not have access to these areas, possibly for many years, because existing businesses have transfer permits that have locked up the close-in areas. Only the edges of the district will be available to new companies, discouraging them from localizing or locating in the downtown. This will hurt the constant revitalization necessary to keep our business community successful. I'm not talking about growth. I'm talking about the normal, healthy process of new businesses replacing old businesses. Transferability can be made to work in an RPP district, but it should be carefully crafted in the administrative regulations development process. There is nothing in the resolution that prohibits transferability to be part of the administrative regulations. Don't take my word for it. Ask the city attorney. Please do not hardwire transferability into the resolution. It is premature, unnecessary, and most troubling. The unescapable irony of making permits transferable is that those very businesses that are most underparked get the most benefit from transferability. Is that what this council wants to do? Okay. Just to move on to the one last item, and that is permit priority for low-wage workers. We're all for giving low-wage workers a break on the price, $100, as opposed to $466. But they should not have priority over other workers. All workers should have the same priority. All types of workers should have the same priority. Just because someone is low wage, they should get a lower price, but they shouldn't be able to cut in line in front of other workers. One of the issues here, anyway, thank you very much. Those two provisions, I will hope you will delete from the current resolution.
Thank you very much. Next up is Maria Kwok, followed by Michael Hodes and Richard Brand.
Good evening. I want to make this as short as possible.
The mic very close to you, okay?
I gave out a copy of my write-up last night, and
yes.
I hope everybody was able to read it. So I'm just going to go to the conclusion that I have, that I think this measures will result in. The program will have a negative impact on city budget because estimated revenue per my calculation, because based on the presentation of Ms. Sullivan and the survey that was conducted in October, the available permit parking in lots and garages is about 219 based on 28% occupancy. And the city streets parking available is about 1,500 to 1,900 from what I understand in the presentation that was done at the Channing House. So basically there's about 500 parking spaces we're talking about, because 80% of that 1,500 or 1,900, there was a survey done and they found out that 80% is occupied by residents at this time. So what we're talking about is about 500 parking spaces, and 300 of those is the neighborhood streets. So in other words, it's gonna be impacting the city budget because you're not really gonna have that revenue. And if you have 516,000 revenue, that means you are selling more parking permit than is available, which is significantly higher than what is available. So it's not gonna solve the parking problem. Instead, it's gonna encourage more people to use it. So that's one of the conclusion that I got. And the others is the new full-time permit users will displace part-time permit users, because these people are gonna be parking, you know, the assumption is these are workers who work in downtown. So they will be parking longer hours. So the part-time permit holders right now who are parking in permit parking spaces, who park there only 2 to 3 hours a day, will now be replaced by full-time parking holders. And so that will have an impact on businesses. Parking permit fees would unfairly burden residents and downtown employees. This program will also benefit commercial property owners, especially the new developments. And it will also, I'm sorry.
Okay.
More thing is it will encourage non-parking permit holders to park on city streets for several days, maybe months, which has been happening right now.
Thank you very much. Michael Hodes, I knew I saw you. Greetings.
Thank you. Council members, I've lived at the same address in Professorville on Bryan Street since 1978, so I've seen a lot of this happen, especially in the last 10 years. I was one of the 6 Downtown North and Downtown South resident representatives on the stakeholders group that met for five downtown business representatives to develop the RPP program that you see before you, and with the hope that it would improve the quality of life in the residential neighborhoods by reducing non-resident parking to an acceptable level. These hour-long meetings went on from March to October as we worked to develop the key elements of what you see before you now.
Michael, get even closer to the
mic.
Yeah,
sure. It's the result of an impressive number of compromises, as several people have pointed out. The resolution is not perfect. In fact, I think it's safe to say that it was extremely rare that all of us agreed without reservation on any given decision. Nevertheless, an impressive majority now support what was ultimately submitted. I'm here on behalf of my colleagues to say that it's time to put something in place to see what can be learned. We hope that the 6-month phase one component will provide essential data that will in turn help ensure the success of phase two. As my neighbor and fellow stakeholder Richard Brand opined recently, this resolution is like an arch. Take any one component risks having the entire structure fall apart. Please don't let this happen. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Richard Brand.
Good evening, and thank you, neighbor Michael Hodes.
I'm sorry.
Richard Brand.
Who had a question? I apologize.
Oh, hang on. I'm sorry, I was concentrating on the next person. For Michael?
For
Yes, please.
Okay.
You heard Mr. Cinch's comments on transferability, and as I understand it, that was added by the Planning and Transportation Commission. Do you regard that as part of the arch, or do you, does your group have an opinion, or what's your thoughts?
I think his point is well taken. Personally, I can't speak for the whole group. It's not something that was discussed in the Lake Stakeholders Group, and it was not something that was part of the original proposal until it was put in by the Transportation Commission.
Good, thank you.
You're welcome.
Good. Sorry, I missed your question.
Okay, again.
Hi again, Richard.
Yeah, Richard Brand. I live in Professorville, and I also was one of the stakeholders of the group. I may run over a little bit because Sue Nightingale, retail stakeholder, last night cannot attend tonight, and she asked me to speak. I actually have written some, which I normally don't do,
but I'll give you just an extra minute because I understand that, but we haven't indulged anyone else yet.
I know. We're all tired. I agree. So I lived this Palo Alto Weekly article this week. I live right here on this corner in this street looking towards university. Says it all. I think you've seen that. And I think that's what we want to eliminate. So I just leave that as a point. But I also want to say that I think the staff permits are one leg of a three-leg stool. And the work that they're looking at to better utilize the parking garages and the traffic management, I think, is critical to get people out of cars. It's one of the goals of the council this year, and I think it's a good one. So all I'm going to say is I'd like to say six things that I ask you to do. Approve the resolution as it is. As Michael said, this thing is very tenuous. We worked on it diligently, and if you start messing with one thing, because we compromised. So also, secondly, the fee structure. Keep it the way it is. The reason that we did the fee adjustments was to get people into the garages. Some of you have seen the video that we did. Staff did a great job on that. Get people out of the parking residential areas and into the garages. And the fee structure was done in the stakeholders meetings to do that. Number three, I think this is important. Advise staff, not as a part of the motion, but to keep the stakeholders committee active. Of course, we can't force people to do that. I think it's important that as we get to the end of a phase one trial, we're kind of experts in this whole thing now. And so I think that we want to keep that group active so that as we go into phase two, we have some experience and knowledge. Number four, assign a council member to participate. Council member Burt actually sat in the first meeting. I think the majority of the group wanted to have a council member, and it was rejected by staff. But I think that was something we should have done so council is aware of this delicate balance we established. I think number five I'm going to take away, I'll say number five is, and you've already done this, is congratulate the staff. They've done a great job. We all have said that, you said that, and I think that's great. So I want to just say that this is not a residents versus business issue. That the, like I said, I'll take 30 seconds more.
It's okay, and then there's already a question for you, and there may be one from this
end.
So.
Okay, so you saw the video that we did. Ms. Nightingale, who owns the Watercourse Way, was also supposed to be in the video. Phil's Coffee, Watercourse Way, myself, we all agreed that what we've got is a great thing. It's not perfect. As you said, Madam Vice Mayor, it's the best we can do. Let's go forward with it. Let's not micro rebuild it. And so I ask you to pass the staff recommendation. Thank you.
Great. And hold on. Council Member Burt has a question for you.
Richard, did the stakeholder group discuss this issue of not only the price preference for low-income workers, but the accessibility of permit preference?
Yes, we did. And the idea was, again, to because we wanted residential quality of life, part of that is that we have service workers that provide us with goods and services on a retail level. That's why we did the pricing issue, but also the prioritization.
because we felt that some of the people that come to work, let's take Whole Foods, come to work at 11 a.m. in the morning, the streets are filled up by people that come to work at, you know, at 8 o'clock. In my case, this street that I showed you fills up, it starts filling at 6:15 in the morning. So yes, we talked about both, and we reached consensus on both.
Okay, I think you're set, Richard, thank you. Norm?
So I wanted to follow up on my previous comments about the spreading of the problem. The no overnight parking program in Crescent Park is a good example of my point. That started out with just a few residents near the Newell Street Bridge being concerned about folks from East Palo Alto parking in front of their house all night. So they approached the city and eventually got the no overnight parking permit program instituted for a relatively small number of blocks. Immediately, the folks from East Palo Alto moved out from that area into adjacent blocks. And so it wasn't long before they petitioned to join in to the program. And eventually they were able to join in. And then as soon as those signs went up there, it moved out further. And now if you drive down University Avenue, you see they're all parked along University, and the City Council recently extended the program to that area, assuming people petition for it, which I think they will. So we have a situation where 10 times the number of households that were originally affected are now forced to buy permits and go through that hassle. And I think it's kind of ridiculous that the problem that was originally confined to just a relatively narrow area has forced all those people to join into the program, wherein, but for the program, they would never have had to have done that. Now, I'm totally in favor of passing the ordinance and the resolution, but I think you got to take into account this spreading effect. Council Member Berman, I think, said that RPP was the backbone of the effort to have transportation demand. Did I use up my time?
You're just about dead. I'm timing you on my...
My light's off. Anyway, my point is, we got to pay attention to that, and I would urge you to make sure that when the regulations go into effect, we limit the commercial parking in the adjacent annexed areas. Thanks.
Thank you. Herb Borak and then Frank Slattery. Are you here tonight, Frank Slattery?
I support adoption of the resolution, and I believe that...
Mike again.
I believe support the resolution. I believe it would be appropriate at this time to indicate that any areas annexed would not allow employee permits. Slide 9 says that annexation would become subject to the regulations of the district. Well, if the district, so it would be appropriate to do it now. And as far as gaming the system, you can't do that because staff has to do a survey. And you can tell from this survey that area that was potentially annexed is not now impacted by employee parking. Looking at a particular resolution now is an opportunity to highlight some of the things that were discussed in the discussion of the ordinance in regard to special events that might occur during the days and hours when the parking restrictions are in effect. There has to be some indication of who is allowed to do that and whether there's a cost. I mean, for example, if Stanford has a football game and people don't want to park at Stanford, and as they do now park in the neighborhood, that wouldn't be an event. if it was some Friday night or people arriving Friday afternoon, or you might want to do it for something else. And the question is, for how wide an area would that cover? If there was noticing for two blocks, does that mean it only applies to the cars that are within two blocks of that event? In regard to the language of stopping, standing, or parking, those words mean different things in the vehicle code. It has to do with whether the engine's on and whether somebody's in the car. So I believe all those words are appropriate, and it would be well for staff to review the definitions of those words, I believe, in the vehicle code, because I believe it was a mistake to delete some of them, as was done in the first reading of the ordinance. I think that the concern that Mr. Beamer expressed about the area spreading would only happen if you allow the employee parking in adjacent areas. And since you know that that would be a problem now, it would make sense to include within the resolution that it wouldn't be allowed. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Slattery.
Good evening. I think a residential parking permit program is a good idea, and I appreciate all the work that's been done also. But while the RPP may be a good idea for the core downtown area, the initial coverage area should not extend to areas that aren't currently impacted with parking, where the program will simply be burdensome and unnecessary. Happily, the area south of Lincoln, east of Bryant, where residents were overwhelmingly opposed to it for those reasons, was already excluded as part of a gerrymandering effort that was appropriate based on the survey results. The area east of Middlefield, north of University, should also be excluded from the initial coverage area for the same reasons. Extending the boundary of the program to encompass this area seems based on the accident of the geography of the creek rather than assessment of the need and applicability. The survey data shows that the area I'm talking about has substantially lighter parking during the day than at night. There have been a number of comments about not letting the perfect be the enemy of the good, but cleaving off this area will do nothing to undercut other aspects of the program. And if and when such unaffected areas might at some point become impacted, they can be annexed to the program as the proposal already provides. I think it's probably easy to say, what's the harm in including a slightly larger area? In response, I won't try to list all the possible reasons that the southeast corner vehemently set forth, but I will simply state that imposing new regulations and requirements on areas that don't need it would be wasteful by the city and burdensome to residents. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Last one is Nielsen. Sort of the kind of the caretaker of this entire program.
I've got a couple of things to say. First of all, I'm in favor of moving ahead. This is as good as it's going to get. People have worked awfully hard. Every one of us can pick this thing apart. There's no doubt about it. I think the most important thing to do is quit complimenting Jessica, because someone's going to hire her away.
I thought of that tonight. I really did.
The whole thing is going to collapse. So that's a little levity, but it's a lot of truth in it. For no other reason that so many of us have so much confidence in what she and Hillary put together, which we did not have when we started. I was listening to the radio, and we had one of those perpetual stories about what makes this a valley successful in an entrepreneurial sense. And it really struck me, that's exactly what's happened. We've come up with a concept, and the concept's embedded in the ordinance and the resolution. It has got a lot of details that's got to work out. And the secret to Silicon Valley is that people can execute on concepts most of the time. But when they do execute, they do an awfully good job. And that's the next two steps, or executional steps. Proof of concept is the next 6 months or the next 9 months, whatever it's going to be. And it's the same thing a bench scientist is doing out at the medical school. They're sitting there just trying to make sure that this thing actually tests out a little bit. And if it does, they go on to the next step, and that's phase two. Phase two is the really smoothing on out. And I think everyone's made the point over and over again tonight is that we just got to hang with this thing because it ain't perfect. And you've got to give us a chance. I know we're available to staff. Staff probably doesn't need a lot of help in the next 6 months, so we need to get out of their way. Let me close back to Jessica. And I've said this before to the council. I'm just really concerned at times that staff does not have enough depth to carry out the chores that we give them. I think this is a bigger than we think problem to solve. And I know Jim and Hillary are working on proper staffing, but Tommy Detrick actually brought up the staffing issue. What happens if we have two things that go hot on us, two different neighborhoods, and we don't have the staff even to do one? So I close on that cautionary note. Thank you, and I hope to see this thing go forward April Fool's Day. Thank you.
Thanks, Nielsen. I really appreciate that and his comments to you, Jessica, as well. If there's anything that any of the speakers have said that you want to respond to, this is a good time. Okay. In that case, who'd like to jump in? And my only regret at this point is that I think this is such an incredibly important program, and we're dealing with it at 11:30 on a Tuesday night, not even a Monday. It's 11:30, and you know, you've got this band of five merry people up here attempting to deliver it tonight. Okay, I think I saw Councilmember Schmidt's light first, then Klein, then Price.
Good, thanks to everyone. And it sounds like there's agreement reached through the stakeholder groups and the staff of developing a phase one program we can move into. So I think that's our goal and target tonight. I just have two simple questions to raise. This has been a big, long, difficult problem because it is clearly, for the city, our biggest and longest lasting issue on the parking side. So being able to deal with this effectively will be a good model for other things we do, and it will force the city council to deal with the parking, the permanent parking issue. A couple minutes ago, we passed an ordinance that would guide us through this. And the guidance, the ordinance clearly said that we need to learn, get good data, so we're operating on good data. And I think the setup in phase one is to generate some good quality data for us to move ahead on. The ordinance also said very clearly that the responsible party is the city council, and it's the city council that needs to be responsible for dealing with the outstanding issues that are going to manifest themselves in phase one. How many permits will there be? Are they transferable? And what kinds of priority do we want to give to handing out the permits? Now, the resolution says in section 5, on page 4, the bottom of page 4, the permit priority, it says, at the end of phase 1, the director shall consult with the Planning and Transportation Committee to deal with these issues. Now, we just passed an ordinance that said the council should deal with these issues. So I think one thing we should change here is that E section should read, the council shall determine the number of permits and the other issues like transferability that stand out. So that's one point, is that we have a direct commitment, you know, of the council to deal with the data as it comes from phase one and deal with the likely big issues that will occur. Second issue that hasn't been discussed very much in any of the things is cost. I think we do have some numbers. $1 million total cost of both one-time and ongoing cost. 2 days ago, we got a copy of the comprehensive annual financial forecast, and it had a number in there, which is very disturbing. It says that 74% of the property tax is paid for now by residents. That number has gone up 8 percentage points over the last 8 years. It's an inevitable march. It means that while we are expanding dramatically our commercial space in town, the revenues generated for things such as this program coming from the commercial side are declining. And that is deeply upsetting. So I think it is important that as we move forward and deal with the cost of phase one, phase two, permanent changes, and especially how we respond to the extra cars in dealing with them, that we identify a way for the commercial sector to pay a fair share of the costs that are being generated. So I would say that that would be a priority for the council to deal with in coming months. So those are the two main issues I see with on the council side that we should do to take be ready for moving ahead with phase one.
Councilmember Klein.
Well, I think this has been an extraordinary procedure and one that I commend. So I'm going to have be taking the unusual position, at least for me, of supporting the recommendation of the group, even though I might not agree with each and every position that they've taken. Because I recognize that this is a compromise, and I like the idea that we have the support of...
Is that a motion or a comment?
I will get there.
It's a preamble.
It's a preamble. I want to start with that, despite being interrupted by the Vice Mayor, as a prelude to asking the one question I really have, and that is... And that is, I worry about the two-hour use of any space in the district by somebody who doesn't have a permit. And so how are we going to avoid the classic two-hour samba where a non-permit holder runs out and moves his or her car to some other section of the neighborhood? And I worry that that defeats the whole idea. I'm sure you've thought about it, and I just want to hear what the answer is.
Thank you, Councilmember Klein. This was definitely a topic of much discussion. I think the idea of the two-hour parking kind of goes hand in hand with the low-wage employee permit. I think we made the low-wage employee permit recommendation to. Based on direct feedback from businesses that employ many hourly workers, such as Whole Foods and Watercourse Way, which have 50 or 100 employees who are right now all parking in the neighborhoods and moving their car every two mm-hmm. hours. And many of them, actually the overwhelming majority of them, said that at the $100 annual fee, they would be thankful to purchase a permit and not have to move their car around. So we expect that certainly there's probably going to be a small percentage of people that just don't want to participate and want to keep moving their cars around. But we, the group ultimately recommended that, you know, we check it out during phase one, and if we do see that happening, we can make an adjustment. But I think the other perspective is that to limit the parking to 2 hours and then not allow a car to move is unduly restrictive without the creation of zones. Like what they do in San Francisco is you can park for a certain number of hours in the G zone and you have to move to the K zone and all that. We have a district which is fairly large, and we felt that it would be unduly restrictive to say that somebody couldn't park for 2 hours, you know, near Middlefield Road and then go to University to run another errand. So kind of some of the discussion that happened around that idea.
I'm assuming that all of the language that appears in the draft resolution on packets page 989 and following, all of the changes are the changes that the Planning and Transportation Commission made?
That's right. All the changes are those that were made by the commission, or just some cleanup changes that we made after the commission's input.
Well, could you guide me through which ones that are cleanup ones that you made? Because I want to move the resolution as it came out from the support, your study group, with any cleanup ones. I want to delete the ones added by the Planning and Transportation Commission, particularly the ones with regard to transferability.
Jessica and Cara can help me here, but I think the substantive changes that were made by the Planning and Transportation Commission are on page 4, the one about transferability of employee permits, also about the Planning and Transportation Commission being consulted during phase one about permit priorities.
So all of the language in paragraph E was added by the Planning and Transportation Commission.
And I think everything else is really falls in the category of cleanup, either was pointed out by the commission or something that we did concurrent with the commission's changes.
Okay. I will move the draft resolution deleting the language added by the Planning and Transportation Commission in paragraph C, Roman 2, 1, may be transferable, et cetera, and also the language under, they've added and deleted under paragraph E at the bottom of that page.
So leaving in the transferable?
Well, two things. One, they added language about transferability, and second, they added language and deleted other language with regard to developing having the director develop language
right.
as to
yes.
How many permits to be issued.
Okay. Just as a clarification, the language in the highlighted language in E on page 4, we added to comply with a particular vehicle code section, so we would suggest keeping that portion in.
Okay.
Waiting for a second, and if not, I will be glad to second it.
Seconded
by Councilmember Schmidt. So, Councilmember Klein, that opens it up, and do you want to speak any further to your motion?
No, I think this has been, I've already really said what I wanted to say. It's been a great process. As many of the people have spoken, is this going to work? Well, we're going to find out. It's an experiment. I think it has a good chance of succeeding, but by no means are we 100% sure. So I want to see us get going, and I really appreciate everybody's work, and so hope we can move forward on it.
Okay, who else wishes to speak to the motion? Councilmember Price.
Yeah.
Oh, I am so sorry. Greg, it was you who seconded it. Thanks.
Yes, I agree that it is time to move forward, that we are achieving our goal and deadline we set almost a year ago to have something available in January. I think this does it, and I think the two amendments proposed by Council Member Klein capture critical changes.
Thank you. Council Member Price, followed by Council Member Burt.
Yes, I have a question. Can you speak to the issue of transferability briefly, why you think that should be taken out?
Well, I think Mr. Sintz made some very good arguments, but I'm worried, first of all, that it was not discussed by the stakeholder group. Mm-hmm. This is not a trivial question. No, we don't do that. and I don't think it's been fleshed out at all. May be transferable between employees within a specific business. That in effect gives that business a permanent lock on those permits. And I don't think that's what we intended. It just bothers me that this is a major thought, and I think that before you add it, we really needed to vet it a lot more. Maybe it would work, maybe it wouldn't, but I think Mr. Sintz has pointed out enough problems so that we should not include it in the trial period.
Okay.
I apologize. I'm not hearing very well. I'm wondering if Council Member Klein could review item number 2 there. Was it your intention to replace Planning and Transportation Commission with City Council, or just remove Planning and Transportation Commission, which was added? I know this was a point that was made by Council Member Schmid, but the way the resolution was drafted, it really left this decision-making between Phase 1 and Phase 2 to the director, the idea being that it comes back to the City Council at the end of Phase 2 for you guys to bless it or change it as needed.
No, I knew what I was doing, that I wanted to eliminate, that give you, the director, the authority to make the changes in between Phase 1 and Phase 2, because okay. We're still in the experimental stage. The Council will have the full authority when it comes back at the end of Phase 2.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Let's see. Yeah, I thought the motion was to the director shall recommend to the City Council, not shall make the decision.
Yeah. Do you?
Okay.
Councilmember Klein, you're where you are, and so you are you ready?
Councilmember Schmidt and I are disagreeing on this.
That's what I'm hearing. So
okay,
so, yes.
Let me just propose a wording there that it would read, during Phase 1, the director would recommend to the council the maximum number of employee permits and so on.
I would second that. I actually agree with that. You want to speak any further to it?
I think Phase 1 is meant to generate some extremely important information about what happens, how many parking spaces are taken by Stanford and Caltrain people, how it adapts to having cost associated with it. And that information is going to have an important impact on how the council thinks about how many spaces do we need to create to keep the business vital in downtown. So I think the council should be engaged directly.
I'll be glad to accept it.
You'll be glad to accept that?
Yeah.
So put that, you can put that in as just a portion of the motion now. Okay. Does that take care of it for you, Councilmember Schmidt?
Yes.
So that's what you wanted to have included
yes,
in that.
Absolutely.
Okay, now I think we're up to you, Councilmember Price.
Yes, thank you very much. It's great to be at this point. I'm really thrilled, as we've said before, and again, deep thanks to staff and to the community stakeholders, everyone who's been involved in this arduous, complicated, intriguing process that's coming to an end at this phase. Just one general comment. I will be supporting the motion as proposed. It is my hope that at the end of the day, that if all of these other elements of the parking strategies and mobility management happens in the city of Palo Alto, that perhaps at some point we can reduce the extent of this RPP program. Because in fact, if people make choices where they're not using single occupancy, you know, being single occupants in vehicles, they use the transit, if they use the shuttle, if we expand the shuttle, and if we have a very effective TDM program, it would be great that a successful evolution would be less reliance on this element of the overall strategies and more reliance on the other options, and a key part of that is behavior change. But I think what we're doing and all of these elements that have been discussed and evaluated are very positive and very creative, and I look forward to this success of this part of it, and I look forward to seeing the results in these various phases. Thank you.
A few comments and questions. First, at a high level, this process with the stakeholder group, I think, reiterates to us how multi-stakeholder groups that are facilitated and well designed in their function allow complex issues to move forward in Palo Alto that otherwise would not have consensus and would not have as good of designs. And it's a lesson to remind ourselves of, because in recent years we haven't used this tool as much, and I think we paid a price for it. Second, I wanted to understand a little bit on what additional modifications, what it would be the process for other modifications between phase one and phase two. We just had this one clarity on the additional permits, but there are things such as the open question of whether there should be transferability, and if so, what kind of transfers. But I think there are other modifications that are still out there, and this does speak to the value of continuing the stakeholder group throughout this process.
Thank you, Councilmember Byrd. I think there are a lot of refinements. This is part of the reason that we thought this would happen at the director level, subject to then approval by the City Council at the end of phase two. But we thought that the allocation of spaces was something that was going to have to be worked out, as well as the number of employee permits and prioritization of those employee permits. And I'm sure there are going to be other aspects of this program that are going to have to be refined, perhaps more than once.
And by what process?
I think our vision was that the stakeholders would continue to be a resource for us as we collect data, start to assess what we think is happening and what tweaks to the program might be needed. Do you want anything?
Well, I'm sorry, just because of the hour, I get that the stakeholders would have input, but then would this be administrative decisions? Would this come through the council? That's what I'm trying to get at.
I think we drafted the resolution that it would be an administrative process that we would consult with the interested parties and make an informed decision, knowing that that decision could be modified or changed and ultimately would have to be adopted by the council when phase two was concluded. What the Planning Commission suggested is that there should be some kind of public hearing process. Their suggestion was that it would be a consultation with the Planning and Transportation Commission, which was acceptable to us. You know, of course, we're going to want public input. I should say, of course, it is completely the council's purview to weigh in at this point. I am concerned. It takes a lot of staff and time and energy to prepare council items. If phase one is truly a six-month trial, we're going to be preparing the staff report at the middle of the month four to get to the council in time for the six-month end of the program. As well as collecting the data, as well as consulting with the stakeholders. And I just want to warn you, it does place a burden on staff, and I may That's part of the reason we envisioned this to be an administrative process.
Okay. Well, you say an administrative process, and then it would come to the council, so it's not a fully administrative process, right? You're saying it would be an ordinance and come to the council, so.
The way the resolution was drafted, it would come to the council at the end of phase two. So there would be an administrative process in the transition between phase one and phase two.
End of phase two? What am I, once we go into phase two, that's it, right?
In section two of the resolution, it says that the council shall consider whether to make the RPP districts and its parking programs permanent, modify them, or their regulations at the end of phase two.
Okay, I get it. All right. One other comment is that I think that we are likely to have initial spillover impacts, and we're not going to have at the outset the accommodation of all the other mitigations, the ones that we're already planning on and the ones that the kind of the market will drive. And so first, I think we need to make it clear to the public and the surrounding neighborhoods what's anticipated, that there's likely to be those spillovers on day one. And many of them, I think, will actually get sorted out, but that's not gonna make those residents sanguine while that occurs. And it's gonna get sorted out as we implement TDM measures and as people adjust their practices as a result of if it's more and more difficult to find parking, they'll do some of their own actions to adjust. But I think we gotta be out there, otherwise it's gonna come back, gee, why didn't we think of the spillover, how dumb were we? And so we gotta go out there and say, look, this is a likely reality, and anticipate it as best we can and then be adaptive. I would say that we should be more aggressive to try to get certain limited TDMs in place at the time of implementation of phase one, as simple things as a lot of additional bike racks around Caltrain stations. You're not, the Caltrain stations are, and then downtown is not such a long distance that people won't, many people won't choose to go from driving to riding to pick up the train. And we don't have that. All right. Part of the phase two considerations that I hope we're still going to take another look at are variable pricing and whether that should have a role, whether it's in our own lots or in this program. I'm not saying what should be done. I just want to make sure it's not off the table. Is there any intention to have additional surveys? This first survey was a mailed survey, right? Did we request emails from survey respondents?
We did not request emails from survey respondents. However, for the follow-up survey that we plan to administer in phase one, I think we do have a way we can do. We had some, I think, technological limitations the first time around. I think we can potentially administer that survey online. But again, we'll have to work through that.
Okay. Well, I think we may have an ongoing set of surveys that we want to do over time, and being able to move those to online would sure be great. How do we avoid the land rush on not day one, but minute one of this going online so that those who just are savvy enough to book a whole bunch of permits for all their employees at moment one don't dominate the system?
I think that question exactly is why we some of the details of how the permits are sold and how the fulfillment process works are still things we're going to want to work through with our permit vendors. We're specifically looking to hire vendors that are very experienced in selling permits and have recommendations for us. That said, that is why, that's part of why we have the prioritization clause in the resolution, because I think we want to be involved if, you know, for instance, Palantir says, okay, I'm just going to snap up 400, you know, low-wage employee permits and just make them all the closest to downtown. I think we're going to want to have some ability to kind of to manage that and say, okay, we may need to prioritize the permit sales differently if that's what happens. I think our hope is that ultimately we don't have to really micromanage this process, and that ultimately we will have other modes of getting downtown and that we will have other programs to support. But I think at the outset, we're going to have to do a little bit of massaging until we get it right.
And I realize one of the other big decisions on the phase two is whether, well, I don't know if it's truly phase two, but I guess in parallel almost with phase two, is this decision of whether non-resident permits would be sold in the additional annexed areas. And that's not determined right now, is that correct?
So if the way the program is written right now is that there's nothing that says we will not sell employee permits that can be parked for the blocks that might be annexed, because ultimately that's giving the annexed portion a different characteristic than the original program, which is not the way the resolution's written.
And so that's part of my concern, and I don't think that should be an administrative decision. This is going to be a very political decision. But that's not specifically part of phase two. That's part of annexing, correct?
That's correct.
All right, so my question is, what would be the best way if we wanted to include a reference to that being a council decision to be made prior to an action to sell those permits in the annexed areas? I can't do that as being triggered by phase two. I guess it would have to be an amendment that would simply say upon it might be that if any annexed areas, the council would have to give authorization to have non-resident permits sold in the adjacent annexed areas, if that was something that the council wanted to retain decision-making authority over.
Councilmember Britt, I'm just trying to understand. So you would like the council to be able to approve if we would sell non-resident permits in those areas? Well, I guess my question would be, what would be the rationale for
treating to Mr. Beamer?
The new areas different than the...
Mr. Beamer spoke to that, and we've been talking about it. It's basically, right now, we have people who are impacted, and we are looking at, in the non-annexed areas, reducing their impacts. In the areas to be annexed, they're basically unimpacted areas, and they'd only be impacted because we put this program in. So that's the rationale.
Yeah, I do agree with that. We should acknowledge, however, that even within the area that's so-called impacted, there are variations.
I understand there are gray zones, but this is a policy decision.
Okay.
So I will move that for areas, adjacent areas that would be annexed, permits for non-residents would only be sold subsequent to council authorization to do so.
So before it's a motion, Councilmember Klein, would you be willing to include that in your motion?
No, I wouldn't. It's not. I find it unnecessary. We go back to the ordinance we adopted just earlier, section 10.50.080. The last sentence in that says the city council may approve, comma, deny, comma, or modify the annexation.
So the annexation would have to come to us?
Yes.
And at that time, we could place the conditions?
The city council may approve, deny, or modify the annexation.
Okay. I'm okay with that.
Okay. So
but
we can remove that. Or do you want to add?
I'm glad that's clarified, because that wasn't what I think was staff's notion just a moment ago. So, okay.
As I read it, the city council has the authority to attach whatever conditions it wants on the annexation.
Okay, I'm fine. One other question is the apparently high cost of the online permitting. That stood out to me as surprising on the administrative costs of online permitting being like in the $500,000 a year range. Can you explain that?
So the online permit sales is, it's not just building a website and hosting a website. It's actually the fulfillment process, distribution and mailing of permits, as well as customer service. So it's essentially outsourcing, you know, what the folks at Revenue Collections do right now for, it's essentially doubling that amount of work in a third party vendor. So you know, the costs, we're actually interviewing everybody tomorrow. The costs vary widely, and so we want to understand the range of what the service offering is. But the customer service component of having someone available to call if you're having trouble with the website or want to know why your permit didn't show up yet, that's pretty significant.
Okay. All right. Well, hopefully it'll come in the low end or below. And what about apartment dwellers? Well, I'm trying to think through when we say, we have a certain up to 4 permits that can be sold per residence. Is an apartment viewed as a residence?
Yes, it is.
Okay, great. And downtown apartment dwellers, will they be eligible if they wanted to participate in this?
Yes, as long as they're within the boundary that we've specified. The boundary doesn't include changing existing regulations in the commercial core and the SOFA district areas, but people who live in those areas would be eligible to purchase RPP permits.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. And has everyone spoken who wants to say something? So at this point, I have two or three things I want to ask about. And I think Nielsen has gone, but the 8 to 5, Monday through Friday, why was it limited not to 6, or why not at all on the weekends? It would seem though the workers are going to be working all weekend long, and most of the workers we're talking about don't have a 9-to-5 job, or they don't have a Monday through Friday job.
I mean, the results of the survey indicated a pretty strong majority wanted that, you know, those hours.
So what you're saying then is that the residents in that area weren't complaining about the open spaces that are there on the weekend.
Correct.
Which seems very surprising to me. But and going to 5 o'clock seemed to be late enough to them, correct?
For most people that responded, yes.
Interesting. So I'm very pleased that the transferable aspect of this was removed, because I think that would get very complicated. And lastly, I'm also pleased that we discussed the annexation, because I do think that's going to be an issue. The one other area of this, and I remember this when we first started going to meetings in downtown North. If somebody wants to have a party, if they want to have people over for a meeting, if they want to have their bridge game, whatever it might be, I think one of the first issues or one of the first areas we're going to run into where there's a problem is people who would like to get more permits than what they can get on a regular basis. So if you get that phone call as soon as this goes into effect, what will you say to them?
I think that's definitely something we've discussed, you know, the certain limit on the number of permits and so forth. We purposely designed we will design the guest permits to be transferable within a household, so a household can purchase, you know, up to 2 guest permits that could be given to a babysitter or a friend who comes over frequently or whoever. In addition, you can purchase the visitor passes, which are daily passes for an event, and you can purchase up to 50. If we have the you know, I think during phase one, we're going to get those phone calls, and I think we're just going to have to sort of, wow, we got 20 phone calls in 2 months from people that, you know, have 10 cars at their house or whatever it is. I think that's just something we need to work with.
So what you're saying, you're aware of it, you anticipate that that could happen, and that's not daunting at this point?
I think we're aware of it. I think ultimately the group felt that we, you know, we did talk about selling unlimited permits, but we also recognized that, and certainly in certain neighborhoods that have a lot of multifamily dwellings, you know, having residents that residential addresses that have 8 or 9 cars associated with them are actually part of the issue.
Right.
And I think that that's something, you know, it's a sensitive topic, but it needed to be sort of acknowledged.
Well, I'm supporting this, and also I would mention anecdotally, my daughter has lived in a community where they've had permit parking the whole time they've lived there, and they are absolutely grateful to have it, even though it does mean from time to time the permits are somewhat awkward. I think they would say that the end product really makes their life far, far easier, especially if somebody's coming to visit. So I think with that, and a big thank you to all of you, I think we're ready to vote. So on the motion which Council Member Klein made and Council Member Schmidt seconded, that is passed 5. It's passed unanimously because we are the only ones who can be here to vote on this. So with that, because the mayor announced that council members' comments and so forth would be taken up next Monday night, unless I have missed something, we are adjourned. And I think Cinderella's pumpkin, or Cinderella's carriage, probably just turned into a pumpkin. Thank you guys very, very much.